Hello, hello, everyone. Warm welcome. It's okay, we admit, 4 minutes, five, almost 5 minutes past 10, but a warm welcome to all of you. And thanks for tuning in. We're live, so everything that will happen now, you will see, and that's great. That gives us a bit tension, that gives the pictures tension. That's what we want. And we want you as an audience. Thanks for tuning in. Today, this is the second Defund Arena of the year. We had a first one in the month of April. This is the second one with six ventures. And today, look at this one. We are welcome now in Concert Noble, which is in the heart of Brussels. It's a very nice location. It used to be a ballroom for noble people, even the royal family. It's built in 1873 by architect Hendrik Bejaard. And I'm so happy because this gives you joy, this gives you pleasure, the perfect arena. We're gonna turn this ballroom into a battlefield. That's what we're gonna do. We're gonna have six ventures that will battle. They will battle in front. They have a huge stage. They have everything they've got to go for that funding. It's tech startups, so I hope you're gonna be very curious. We will judge it, and if I say we, we're gonna turn to the jury. We have jury members, and yes, it's Corona time. That means that we will have digital jury members. Hi, digital jury members. And we will have live jury members. And before we get to you, ladies and gentlemen, I first like to introduce the presidents of that jury. That will be Wim de Waele and Thierry Brunel. Gentlemen, this is the second Defund Arena, again in Corona times. Thierry, that's a hell of a thing, eh?
Yes, so thank you very much for the introduction.
Yeah.
It has been a hassle, and I definitely want to thank, in fact, the whole team who has made this possible, including the Delaware people, in fact, who did a great job to organize it. There was some happiness because we had like a full house. Also, yeah. We had prepared a marvelous catwalk, and then we had to skip to a semi-digital event.
Yeah, and even in this location, it would have been great to have an audience, but we're happy because you're an online audience. So great to have you here. Thierry, you're not alone here. Huh? You're from Delaware, one of the partners of Delaware, a tech company, but you have another president next to you. Please, can you introduce him?
The other president is Wim de Waele. He has been advising us as from day one, in fact, to set up Defund. By the way, we're working on the naming of Defund, so it might become Delaware Venture Investments, but we'll see.
Yep.
But Wim will orchestrate the jury and will tell something more about who they are and will also be master of the content.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much, Brunel. Thanks for being here. Wim, great to have you again on this second edition. And you're proud, I would say, to have again a strong jury. And we know most of them. Can you introduce everyone, please?
Indeed, it's a mix of veterans from the previous edition and new people. I was actually talking to Michel Tombeuf, one of the members, the jury members before. And he told me this used to be the place where the Brussels High Society did their bal des débutantes, debutantes ball, and the matchmaking between the promising youth. And we have a version of that here today, meaning a matchmaking between a number of startups and a jury that will judge based on they already prejudged the longer list of jury member of potential candidates. Down to these six who will present here and do a live pitch. It's in the live pitch that you can really make the judgment, I think, always of the team and the content, and that's the purpose of today. The jury members we've assembled physically, and thank you very much for making it here, and specifically Joël, who just came in at the last moment because of the horrible traffic jams I heard on the ring road. Thanks for being here, but also the people who are digitally present because of all the travel restrictions and everything that COVID's done to us. A warm welcome. Let me just quickly run through. I already introduced Michel. Michel is from SPDG, a venture capital firm, was also there at the previous session. Clotilde Anne is new to the jury. She's from B Angels, the Angel Network. in Belgium, that's very strong in Brussels and the whole of the country. And we thought it was useful to, next to VCs, also add an angel network representative in our jury. Eric represents Microsoft, one of the Eric Kerkhoff, one of the large partners of Delaware, who also have several complementary incubation programs. And Joël, the last person physically present, as I already mentioned, came over, I think, from Antwerp, and represents Inkev Capital, another venture capital firm. And then on the digital side, we have a nice Benelux representation there, because we have Frank Klaassen from Nuon, a large Dutch VC that's also very active in Belgium. Also one of the veterans from the first session, together with Jürgen Engels from Smartfin. And then they're joined by Jeroen Kremers from Scale Up Capital, who's making his debut here, and Mark Giel from SAP, the other large corporate partner, technology partner. Mark joins us from the UK. Welcome, Mark, from across the North Sea. So that's the jury. I think once again, we have a good panel, a balanced panel that will help us in judging the startups. The process, as that most of you already know, is simple. There's six pitches, half an hour each, 15 minutes pitch, 15 minutes discussion, questions. It's an informal setup, so feel free to fire whatever question you have. At the end, I'll ask each of you if you're interested in pursuing the discussion by just raising your hand, the discussion with the startup. If you feel not necessarily to invest right away, of course, but just if there is an interest in the case and the team. And then we'll close the session and go to the next startup. That's the process. So I think we're ready for the first startup. Good.
We have a strong jury, Wim, and thanks for introducing them. But, and I can assure you, we have six ventures, promising ventures, tech ventures. And to give you an insight on the previous Defund Arena, what we did in April, if I'm well informed, they are three out of six that have funding now, and they're up and running and doing everything. So it's a promising thing. Again, we have new ventures. I'm looking forward to some. Let's start with the first venture. And its first startup will be QViro.com. So QViro.com is the large stand, most trusted industry 4.0 marketplace. It's a marketplace helping industrial users make confident decisions based on authentic peer reviews. Gentlemen.
Morning.
Good morning.
You're shining.
Thank you.
And that's good, because it's all about people today. They've been reading everything that you've been sending. They've been reading the presentations. They've been reading the business plans. Now it's about people, and you shine, which is good.
Thank you.
All right, all right. You have a beautiful stage. We have a strong jury. So the rules are like this. You will have 10 minutes of presentation. We will have a countdown, and I'll help you with this. 10 minutes presenting. After the presenting, there will be a Q&A session, questions and answers, for about 20 minutes max. And after that one, we will ask the big question, like, who of them is interested to continue talking to you? That's the main important thing, all right?
Awesome.
We're all warm. It's a beautiful setting. I would say, hit it, guys. Come on, there we go.
Perfect. Okay. Dear members of the jury, I would like to ask you a question to start off. If you have ever used a review to select a restaurant, a mobile phone, or a hotel room, please raise your hand. I see all of you. Well, 9 out of 10 people use reviews before they make a purchase. But in our industry, reviews didn't exist. So what is our industry? Well, we operate in the industry of smart manufacturing, also called Industry 4.0. So our platform, qviro.com, is the biggest online marketplace for industrial technology, where industrial users can make confident decisions based on peer reviews. So I would like to start with by introducing our team. Both Jorge and I have very much experience in the industry. Combined, we have visited 150 production plants in 20 countries. And last year, we organized the biggest online industrial fair for the Benelux, where we had paying customers like Siemens. Of course, we don't have expertise in every field, which is why we use technical experts to guide us with the development of the platform, with legal expertise, with content writing, and so on. And we also have some very good partners in our industry, like Aghoria and Vlerick Business School. To continue, I would like to discuss and take you in the head of the buyers and the sellers of our two-sided marketplace. On the one hand, you have the buyers, which are engineers or purchasing managers in manufacturing plants like Volvo Trucks or Toyota, Pfizer, and so on. Engineers who have a production line that needs to move, but every week they have a new challenge of improving and they need better technology. But for them, it's hard to see these fancy technologies and to know how they can implement them in their factory line. It's also difficult to compare all brands on the market, and it takes often a few months before you can get a price indication of the solution you will get. On the other side, you have the sellers of technology, and they also struggle. On one hand, they struggle because they need to create brand trust for their products. It's hard for them to find leads, and it's hard for them to get honest feedback from their product users. And trust us, both Jochen and I, we have faced both of these struggles, both selling and buying, which is why we launched this platform. And this is what the website looks like. Every month, thousands of visitors from all around the world already use qviro.com. They filter on their application, find all brands to compare, get an instant price indication, and they can read reviews and also compare the technologies to one another. So it's one place where an engineer starts his journey to make a short list of, let's say, three solutions that he wants to proceed. Do we have competitors? Yes, of course we have competitors. On one hand, we have these big websites like Direct Industry, where you have a lot of companies being listed or a lot of products, but they don't give value. They don't help you in making a decision which one is better than the other one. And then we also have some expert platforms where we see that it's often robotics experts who talk from their own expertise, which is not so scalable because they can't scale to other areas. And we try to be the leader because we are scalable because we use the expertise of the crowd, and we also want to go to all categories. Now, Joch will explain to you how we go to the market.
So, how do we stay ahead of our competitors? And we do this with our growth strategy, and we focus on three pillars. The first pillar is focused on the content that is available on our platform. And that content will grow to up to 100 product categories. At the moment, we have four of them online, all based in the field of robotics. The second pillar is focusing on our users of the platform. These are the potential buyers. And we reach a global audience by organic reach and targeted digital marketing. And thirdly, we of course need the suppliers of those technologies, and these are the sellers or manufacturers. And as we list them already all on our platform, we have a very detailed view on who are our potential customers, so we can target them very easily, and we also can attract them by giving some bait, some data insights, or some leads that we already generated by our platform. And how do we make money? To make clear for all of you, we don't sell hardware, we don't sell robots, but what we do is the users can use our platform for free because the suppliers pay for it. But we list all suppliers globally on our platform. We do that for free, but they pay for us for additional services. And what are those additional services? First of all, what we do is we generate brand trust for them. So together with them, we generate reviews that can result in, let's say, industry awards and so on. Secondly, we generate a lot of data. And a lot of those users on our platform, these are highly qualified leads because they are in their purchasing journey. So they want to buy a new robot or want to buy a new smart machine. And we generate those direct and indirect leads, and of course, we sell them to those suppliers. And thirdly, because we have that amount of data, we have a lot of intelligence of the market globally. And that intelligence, based on those reviews and those visitor data points, we generate in industry reports that can generate a lot of interesting insights. Last summer, we started selling our three solutions, and initially we thought, okay, these are big industrial players, a sales cycle will take about 6 months, but already now, we already have signed up some very big names, for example, ABB, it's a big multi-dollar company that already signed up for our services, and also, for example, the South Korean Dosan. And also in the upcoming weeks, we will sign up companies from Canada, Denmark, Taiwan, that will start using our services from the beginning of next year. And this is necessary because we need to grow fast. At this point, we already showed a lot of traction. We have signed customers, but for now, for us, it's now very important to stay top of mind. And we want to reach those 100 categories within the 5 years. And that's why we also will triple the amount of categories in the upcoming year. And it's a huge opportunity because if you look to, let's say, a different industry, for example, the one of B2B software, you see several players with the more or less same business model already in the field. You have, for example, Capterra. They are acquired by Gartner. You have G2.com. I think they are evaluated at about $1 billion. And of course, our segment, the world of Industry 4.0, is slightly smaller, but still the opportunity is huge. So, Defund, are you ready to join our adventure in the fantastic world of Industry 4.0? Always welcome. Thank you.
This is so strong. This is so good, guys. You're a team. And this was a good 10 minutes, so thank you. It was interesting to me.
Thank you.
But I'm not part of the jury. No. So, jury members, and first, Thierry and Wim, you can orchestrate this one. Do you think there are any questions? Because we're going to start a Q&A session now of 20 minutes. Good luck, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'll keep my questions for later. I'd prefer to have the jury members first. Launch their questions. So I'll first ask the people who are physically present here. Anybody who's willing to bite the first bullet? Go ahead, Latine.
Thank you for your presentation. First question, obviously, machines are key in the success of a production flow, the logistic processes.
Can we get closer or no? Okay.
Raise the volume, yeah.
I'll try to speak up as well.
No, okay.
Obviously, machines are key in the production process, the logistic process. Why would, let's say, a company in the automotive, Ford, will disclose which machine is really effective in their logistic process and knowing that Volkswagen is going to see that? What would be their interest to review a machine that they are using and knowing that competition will know that they're using that and that it's really effective?
Sven, can you maybe explain?
Yes. You are talking about the review captation, I assume. We have made this question to ourselves. Will we ask the end users like Ford to write the reviews, or will we ask integrators? Because in our industry, it's quite common that you also have an integrating party who is doing the implementations. And these people are also the one with the most programming experience. So we ask these integrators to write the reviews. Still, the companies like Ford, even though it's a most of the time a technical review, they get the brand trust based on these reviews. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. That answers your question. Yeah, Michel.
Thank you for your presentation. First, a short question and then a last one.
Okay.
When you mentioned something about having 4 out of 100 categories, can you explain exactly what you meant by that? It sounded like you are missing something big, but maybe I misunderstood. That's my first question. And the second one is, I'm not familiar with the industrial world, buyers, sellers, etc. But I have the feeling that the procurement officers in large companies, such as the one you mentioned, they value the personal relationship with their suppliers. They need to go on site, they need to check the machinery, they need to do a lot of comparative analysis. And so my main question is, how comfortable do you think they would be to do this interaction via a platform like this and losing this one-to-one relationship? Because we are talking about big ticket items, you know, long-term investments, CapEx, etc.
Thank you for those good questions. To answer them, so if you talk about industrial automation or Industry 4.0, that's of course a very big market that can go from 3D printing machines to smart machines to Internet of Things gateways. And we decided to focus ourselves also with the limited resources we have on specific categories. So instead of going directly to the full Industry 4.0 market, we focus on some sub-product categories. In our case, it's all related with robotics. So collaborative robots, SCARA robots, all very specific niches. But these will enable us, and we already are doing it, that they validate our business model, that we see traction. And then now we will expand those product categories so we can have the whole Industry 4.0 market. To give you also an example, ABB is a customer in one of those categories, but they of course have a lot of products that they also can be a customer in new segments the upcoming years. And what about the relationship, indeed, of the suppliers? I think a relationship is still very important, but there's also a very rapid development of new technologies. So also for companies like Volvo Trucks, for example, it's for them very key that they still discover new technologies, new suppliers, so they also can be very on track with their technology sourcing, and they also can challenge their existing suppliers to indeed reduce prices or to improve the service, for example.
I would like to use an example. A restaurant owner also has a personal connection with someone who comes to eat. Same for our industry. We don't take that away. We just increase the odds that you find a supplier who is trustworthy, and later on we leave the deal closing and the product development and so on to them.
All right. Joel, you had a question. Sorry.
From a revenue perspective, I always prefer a company to be not on the cost side of the customers, so that you're not a cost to them. So in your case, an opportunity would be that there is some segments in robotics where factories really like to order directly themselves. Is that something you gave a thought? Because that could move you, you know, where 20 years ago people would really value the relationship of the lady in the travel agency telling them which travel to book. And now everybody is booking this online because the tools are so good, they know more than this representative at the agency. Is there an area in your industry that you could pick up like that and then grow there with direct sales, or maybe even being the reseller and make the connection and then take a revenue from that?
It's a very good question, and it's also a question that we already discussed a lot in the past. But we actually made a very clear decision that we want to be a neutral party. And the reason is also we have a lot of experience with buying and selling those technologies. And a robot arm is not a standalone off-the-shelf product. It needs to be integrated in a solution with vision cameras and so on. And this is often done by integrators in a complex installation. So that requires a lot of engineering, requires a lot of analysis. So you will never buy a robot with your credit card.
Yeah.
But never say never. Maybe in the future we will decide to also maybe off-the-shelf products we can offer them. But now our focus really clear to just be the connector of buyers and sellers.
All right. Erik?
Yes, thank you, Sven and Jörg, for a strong pitch. Maybe two clarifying questions. First one to build on Joël's point. You seem to be focusing on equipment, on the hardware piece of things, whereas the IT and the OT world are kind of blending. And to your earlier point, the value, I think, is created when equipment is integrated, for example, in a production flow. So are you considering, have you considered expanding into IoT, cloud platforms, a software world, basically that connects that equipment in a smart factory setting?
Good question, Sven.
Yeah. One of our key things to decide which categories are most relevant is, of course, the complexity, and which is why we choose products who have both the hardware and the software component. But if anything related to MES, ERP, IoT, and so on is also on our roadmap. At the moment, we try to stay away from the things that are already on these platforms like G2 Captera, the ones which are more common softwares, not too much related to the industry world. There we try to stay away from. But IoT platforms are a perfect example of what will be in the future on the platform.
Maybe a slightly different question. To what extent is the marketplace technology that you're building, and you spoke about SEO, for example, at generate demand, et cetera, but to what extent is that marketplace platform unique with I don't know, smart matching, a specific lead flow technology, and would it be applicable to other industries, for example, as well?
I hope I understood the question well. We are the only review platform in our industry. Let's make that very clear. At the moment, we have never seen reviews anywhere else. So that's where we try to position us, as sourcing the knowledge of the crowd to the people. And we try to focus on this first, before maybe later on we will do a more intensified matchmaking with smart software. But at the moment, we try to focus on providing the intelligence of the crowd.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, let's see if this digital thing works. So let me hand it over to the jury members on the other side of the video, the connection. Anybody who's curious or has another question? Frank was first.
Yeah. Does this work?
This works.
Perfect. So first of all, gentlemen, thank you for your presentation. It seems clear to me that you have extensive end-user knowledge, which is a big benefit in starting an initiative like this. My first question is basically a closed one. I'm wondering, are you a software company or a data company? That's the first. And secondly, it's also starting with a statement and then combined with a question. This proposition seems to me like having winner-takes-all characteristics. What, in your opinion, are the consequences of this? So, for instance, if I look at G2, the company with whom you compare your startup with, they have raised over multiple rounds a little bit above 250 million. So, is that also your long-term view?
Thank you for those questions. To answer them, your first question, in our opinion, we are more a data company than a software company. Software is not our differentiator. I think it will also answer a little bit the question that we just had before. So we are really focusing on the data and the data quality that we gather. Secondly, indeed, and I think also one of the last slides, we mentioned it, for us, it's really important that we now grow fast, that we show traction, but now it's important that we indeed capture the market and grow very fast so that we are in top of mind if an engineer starts his automation journey. That he thinks, okay, I need to go to qviro.com and I will find the technology that I need. So indeed, yeah.
Yeah, and we have a sticky business model, which means that if ABB collects reviews and once they have 200, 300 reviews, they won't see the advantages of moving to another review platform later, which is why we have to focus on bringing in as many reviews as possible to capture these companies in.
Okay. Jürgen, you also had a question?
Thanks for the presentation. I had a question on the MRR and the business model. You mentioned in 22 some MRR, so just if you could explain what kind of model you're using. Is that a kind of subscription model? Yes, but for what? So if I subscribe, what do I get in return?
Yeah.
And then based on that, you mentioned data as being an important facet. But if I would be like working in a purchase department of a large company, technically, if I do my job well and I have to buy stuff, I always have peers that I can go to. And a lot of these large companies even have these kind of models inside the company where they know that, okay, in other places in the world, they've also used this technology. So within the company, because they're global companies by definition, I can just ask other departments what their view is. So how does that compete with what you guys want? So why would I go to you if I can get it somewhere else, basically?
Okay, thank you for those questions. To answer your first question, our business model is based actually on a subscription model. So we have the three solutions that we just showed you, and they are starting from 10,000 euros per year. And for that amount, you get all leads or all data that we collect in one of those solutions. So on average, companies pay us between 10,000 and 40,000 euros per year per category. So if ABB wants to join also in other categories, they again need to pay for that data. Okay. That's how it's built. To answer your second question, and this is also based on our own experience, we noticed that sharing best practices in big organizations is really difficult. You mentioned, okay, maybe there's a colleague who had a good experience with a certain technology, but we noticed it's for many engineers, a lot of plant managers, production managers, much easier just to open your smartphone, type something in Google, and find an answer over there. And we want to be there, on their smartphone, on their laptop, when they are searching for inspiration, when they are searching for new technologies.
Yeah, and we always talk about big companies like Volvo Trucks, Tesla, and so on. But we do that because these are companies you know. But we have a very strong focus also on SME companies. Because even though you know the companies Volvo Trucks way better, there are a ton of SME companies, production sites with 100 to 200 people, and they don't have a specialist in every field. So these people go to the internet, they don't have the time to travel to Munich to visit a virtual fair, an industrial fair. They do the research online like they do in their daily lives.
All right. Just for the sake of time, I know the other two people also have a question. So Mark, and then Jeroen, let's take Mark first. Yeah.
Again, thank you for the presentation. Maybe I'd just like to understand the market dynamic. When we're speaking to manufacturing customers in this space, what they're trying to do is digitize their sales process. And they're trying to do this in three ways. One often is through CPQ, configure price quotes, right? The reason why it's difficult to get accurate pricing information is that the pricing is often bespoke based on the product that's being created. Where these customers actually make a lot of their money is actually in the after sales. So actually going from CPQ, building relationship, and then delivering after sales through the same platform is often key. And then in between is the commerce element, right? And so, you know, for this to be successful, you probably need to link into commerce platforms or other marketplaces that are on there. So how do you see that vision, and how do you make sure that you become an integral part of that CPQ through commerce to after sales process?
Sven, maybe you can elaborate a little bit also on the integrations with CRM systems.
You mentioned a few things that these companies are missing. Of course, we have to focus. We cannot solve everything. So that means we don't focus on after sales. We focus on the brand trust and the comparison between brands. That's also to put our focus on something. And I don't know what you,
About the digitalization of the sales process, it's really key that we indeed enable our customers to do efficient sales. And that's why we also worked quite a lot last couple of months about the seamless integration of our data into the CRM systems, for example, of ABB. So they indeed have a continuous flow, and that the data stays digitally over there, and that they have all those data points in their systems.
Okay. One concluding question from Jeroen, who's based in Eindhoven, which has a strong high-tech base in this domain. So go ahead.
Well, first of all, thanks a lot from my side as well. And yes, I can see the challenge here with all these technical companies around me. One question that keeps popping up my mind is that converting from a freemium model to a paid model is often difficult. So when I was reading the decks and when I heard your presentation, I was wondering who is already converting or signing up for the SaaS model? Is that transition already taking place?
Yeah, it's a good question. Yeah, indeed, it's slightly difficult to indeed go from a freemium to a paid subscription. But what we actually do is, let's say, quite smart, in that sense that we generate already a lot of valuable data for those companies, because they are listed on our platform. Potential customers from all over the world are looking to their products. And what we also have is we also show their prices, their list prices on our platform, but you need to log in to see those list prices. And based on that, end users log in and they also consent to give their contact details to those companies. So what we do is we have a lot of valuable data, and what we then do is reach out to those companies like KUKA Robotics or Fanuc, and we say, hey, this is a list of potential leads interested to talk. And a lot of those companies are always very eager to get some samples of data and also to talk with us to see, okay, what's in it. So grabbing their attention is quite efficient at this point.
I will have to stop this one. Short questions, even stronger answers, which is great, guys. You're confident in this, huh? And they're keen on asking questions, which is a good thing.
Yeah, definitely.
But there is one main question. And that question is, I think, posed by one of the presidents. Please, have a go.
So the question was, do you feel interested by this case? Are you interested in continuing the discussion? So raise your hand if you are.
Now we will have to count. One, two. Two of them, the two ladies.
The woman, awesome.
It's the female side of it.
Yeah.
All right. We are not used to have a lot of females in our industry, so that's very good.
It's good, it makes you a bit stronger, huh? All right, you guys happy with the presentation, with the questions?
Definitely. Okay. Strong questions, so thank you for that.
Juvaro, Sven and Jörg, thank you very much. Please, you can leave.
Thank you very much.
That way.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Okay. We will go to the next startup. So Cash Planner is a full automatic cash flow forecasting solutions. Hi guys.
Hi.
That enables entrepreneurs to do business without any financial surprise. Stimulate the impact before they take decisions and get the proactive insights they need to adjust where needed. Again, fresh guys. Good.
Guys.
Yeah. It feels good to be here, no?
It does.
All right. All right. A bit nervous? Or is it okay?
It's okay.
Now it's going okay. As you've been, as you've heard, we have a strong jury, good questions. So you know the system. You have a max of 10 minutes of presenting, and then we will have 20 minutes of Q&As.
All right. Great.
All right. Perfect.
Looking forward.
Okay. Thomas and Dylan. Thomas and Dylan of Cash Planner. Guys, here you go.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. My name is Thomas. This is Dylan. And today we want to tell you about Cash Planner, how we started it, why we started it, for who we are building it, and how we are going to reach these people. Before we start, I would like to introduce ourselves. I met Dylan at the beginning of this year while I was looking for a co-founder. And I met him and he said, I can help you. I can help you reach your target audience. And I said, that's a great idea because I don't know how. I'm a product guy, he's a business guy. He breeds SaaS. Comes from Team Leader and Intuo, and I have been a software developer for the past 10 years. So this is us today, and we built Cash Planner together, and we're going to make this happen. So as I became an entrepreneur some 15 years ago, I made a lot of mistakes, and I learned that if you are navigating blindly as an entrepreneur, and you don't know where you're going to, that you get into trouble. And I got into trouble. I had a lot of financial worries. And at one moment, somebody told me, Thomas, you have to keep a cash forecast. So I learned what a cash forecast was. And afterwards, in a second career as a developer, I talked to a lot of other entrepreneurs about this cash forecast. And it appeared that it was not so, that I was not the only one with that problem. Everybody should use a cash forecast. So I identified a problem that most entrepreneurs navigate blindly. And if you go towards the accountant, he tells you, oh, everything is fine. You had a great year last year, but you don't know what's coming up for you. So then you try to keep a cash forecast yourself, but you notice it's way too time consuming and it's very error prone. And you say, okay, but there's a lot of financial tools who probably can solve that. Well, we didn't find any tools that were built for us entrepreneurs. We found a lot of tools that were built for financial experts, but not for entrepreneurs. So we wrote the first code back in 2019. We founded Cash Planner the first January last year. We did the Brio trajectory, we did the Bertha trajectory, and we learned that we had to stop developing the product and start talking to our target audience. So we did that. We talked to a lot of entrepreneurs, and we created a customer advisory board, which consisted of entrepreneurs, but also of financial people, accountants. Because you probably notice it, we're not financial experts, not at all. So we needed them in our client advisory board. And with these people together, we launched the first version back in January of this year. And this first version was pretty impressive because in the first month, 75 people registered to our software. And we thought we're ready, we're going to start selling now, but nobody bought it. And that's when we learned really what was needed. In the next 6 months, we very much identified the real problem and what was needed as a solution. We needed a fully automated solution. We needed an accurate cash flow forecast, but especially a full cash flow forecast, not only cost and income. I'll tell you about that later on. We needed something where people could simulate the impact of their decisions before taking the decision. So we created that. And all by itself, we needed something, a solution that gives proactive insights into our target audience. So that's what we created. And this summer, we launched our second version, which you see here, and this it's Cash Planner, what it's like now. So this second version, what it does, what the value is, we take some data from accountants, we take some data from CRM, we take some data from the bank, and we make sure people don't have to lie awake about what's coming up for them financially. We do it all for them. They can create simulations. They get an automated forecast. And it's all done automatically. So with this version, we had immediate sales. We had our first, right now we had our first, I'm going a bit too fast. Let me tell you first about a competition. Dylan is going to talk about our audience. It might be that you think, are they not already other tools for cash flow forecasting? Well, there's a lot of financial tools. But we missed some tools that were built for the entrepreneur in a language that the entrepreneur can understand. So as you see on the south of the graph, you see probably a lot of names that you know, like Emisphere, like Bright Analytics, like iController. But these are all tools that do quite a lot of things and are focused to financial experts. And if you look at the top side of the graph, you find CashPlanner there, fully automated for entrepreneurs. You also see EduCap and Float, which are targeting other segments in the market or other markets internationally. So that's why we think and we believe we are in a blue ocean.
So who are those entrepreneurs? So we did a couple of tests to identify the ICP or the low-hanging fruits in the market. And we definitely saw a match with B2B service companies that were selling projects. Why? Well, they need to actually pre-finance projects before they get the money on the bank. So they did it already quite intensely in Excel. So we came with CashPen and they were very excited that we can do it automatically. What is actually the value for them? Well, they can simulate the impact before they actually take decisions, like Thomas said, so they don't need to take any decisions based on gut feeling. You give them financial peace of mind because entrepreneurs sometimes lay in bed or are sitting on the toilet or are standing in the elevator and thinking, what if I was hiring two new account executives? What if they were not on target within 6 months? So before they take the actual decision, they can simulate it in CashPlanner. They can optimize their growth because not every entrepreneur sees the value of cash planning or keeping a cash flow forecast because they have enough money on the bank. Well, with cash planning, we want to show them what is actually needed to run the business and what is actually left to invest in growth so that you can actually get the maximum out of your business. It's also time saving. We know that cash planning is not a daily activity, even though we want to promote it like it is, but it's not, so we keep it up to date for you guys. You get notifications, we give you proactive alerts right here in the pocket, see it as a CFO in a pocket, where you can actually adjust your direction if needed, if there is a potential dip in the future between 4-6 months, etc. So where are we now? We have 30 paying customers and 3 partnerships. Oh, it's 32 paying customers, 3 partnerships. It's already changed this week. So that's a good start. We see that we have a product market fit with the ICP. We give a small demo, 50 minutes. We start getting referrals from marketplaces such as Yuki, but also from Exact Online, which is great. And people are starting to talk about CashPlanner because it's very user-friendly and it's just plug and play. So what are we looking for? We are looking for 1 million euros, 500,000 euros in equity, and with additional resources from Vlaio, PMV, and bank loans. What do we want to do with that? Well, we want to focus on sales and marketing because we believe that we have a very scalable product, very easy to understand, and we want to address a lot of entrepreneurs, not only in Belgium, but also in the Netherlands and further abroad. But we also want to invest in product and infrastructure. So what is the plan? How we are going to scale this? Well, now we're all doing this based on outbound sales, targeting our low-hanging fruits in the market, but we really want to scale from an outbound strategy to a more inbound self-service approach for the SMBs, and we still want to remain the outbound strategy for targeting partnerships and accountants. But now we don't have a free trial, we don't address the full potential of the market, and we want to make it more self-serviced. How we want to do that? There's a lot of information on this slide, but I just want to focus on the 4 pillars. We want to focus directly at the same time on product, acquisition, activation, and retention. In the past, in previous startups, I saw that a lot of entrepreneurs and also in my startups that I worked in, and that we are filling the bucket when it's actually leaking. So we really want to focus on the other pillars on the right side as well, acquisition, activation of a free trial, but also retention. So focus on customer success right away and talk with the customers to evolve the product right away. So what is the goal? We want to reach 500,000 ARR by next quarter or by the second quarter of 2023. We want to focus on SMBs. The product is made by entrepreneurs for entrepreneurs, but we still keep, we left the door open for accountants. So we're partnering with accountants as well to actually approach the full market potential. So these are the goals, and we're ready to scale. So let's hit the pedal to the metal. Thanks.
That's a great quote at the end, and perfectly timed.
Yes.
All right. Hey, guys, perfect. Coders, you're kind of cool guys, eh?
Thanks.
That's good. And I was happy with this startup. Have you noticed that they've been really thinking through the whole process, not just coding, but also the market? I think that's smart. That's a smart way to do. So I'm very curious, this cash plan, what your questions are. Please, presidents of the jury.
Thank you, guys. Thanks, Kurt. I'll switch the order around this time and first ask our digitally present jury members for their remarks or questions. I know some of them certainly have an interest in this domain. So who's willing to bite the first bullet and ask the first question? Yes, Jeroen, go ahead.
Thanks a lot. What I like about the team is that as in your introduction is that you have the business guy and in your own words, the business guy and the product guy. And I think it's great to have this combination on board. Me myself, I have a background in auditing and in accounting, so I'm a little bit familiar with it. But it was years ago. Sorry. what I see now is that it looks like a crowded landscape. Also in your competitor slide, and what we see, especially with startups or with young companies, is that they are searching for free tools like the LTSE startup cash planning tool, which works brilliantly. And I was missing that in the slide. So I'm curious, is the competition there also with the exact onlines and et cetera, who are always trying to incorporate things, or is that the potential exit, or how do you see that? Because for me, that's the most worrying thing, the crowded landscape.
Mm-hmm. So if I understand the question correctly, it is about, are you competing with, for example, Exact Online, or are you integrating with them? Is that the question?
Yeah, or are you competing with them, or are you for them, or?
Yeah. No. We're not competing with them at all. So what Exact Online does is feeding our solution. We are getting our data partly from Exact Online, or Yuki for the matter. We are enriching it. We are enriching forecasted transactions with these data. So Exact Online is one of our sources, for example. Is that an answer to your question?
Yes, yes.
And also the first part of your question, people like to have free tools, especially entrepreneurs, to do their cash flow forecast or cash planning. But we're thinking to connect with the bank directly by next year, and we're exploring the possibilities to have a basic version for the smaller management, how you call it, management companies that want to use it firsthand without the connection with the accounting software. So we're exploring the possibilities to make it as low threshold as possible to get a big audience.
Yeah, maybe even a free version.
Yep. Just,
we're considering the pivots.
All right. Anybody else? Yeah, Jürgen.
Yeah, thanks, guys, for the presentation. Well, I know the field a bit because of Silverfin and Bright Analytics. And what I've seen is that when you look at these companies, they started from the accounting and reporting part, which today they have a decent install base. And for them, the jump towards cash flow projection, which is important, is a necessity, and it's also something they will do, because you first need, as you said, you need to integrate and get your data from somewhere. So either you integrate with your ERP system, or you integrate with a system that also integrates with the ERP system that sits on top of that, and it's a bit easier then to just do this jump to cash flow statements. They haven't done it yet because cash flow is important, but well, the core of the reporting and the accounting was more important. So how are you going to compete with these guys when they come up with in the market with a simple solution integrated with Silverfin and Bright Analytics on cash flow? So that's question number one. And question number two, on your slide, unless I didn't see it, you didn't mention Cashforce, which is a bigger player in Belgium in cash flow management. They're a bit higher up in the sense that they work for larger companies, but they also, as I know, plan to go lower in the stack and start building stuff for PMEs. So in other words, you'll get heavy competition on one hand from guys who have this reporting and who will integrate cash flow on it, and on the other hand, from a player that's already in that field that will come down in the Belgian market. So I'm just wondering, I mean, how are you going to tackle this? Because that's not an easy job to do.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
No, it is not easy at all. We know. We have close relationships with our competitors. We're talking with them as well to see what their plans are. And as we see, and when we're talking to our target audience, they're not willing to pay a lot of money for a very broad tool such as Emisphere or Bright Analytics, which is quite broad. And they only what they want is only something that gives them insights of what is coming at them and what will be the impact of their decisions right now. So we feel that that's the urgency for them, and they don't need everything around it. Besides that, we're in conversations with Silverfin as well to talk about, like, yeah, why don't you guys do this? Because it's very complementary with your systems. And they said, like, we're not going to do this. We're thinking about it, or we thought about it, but we are focusing on scaling the product and make it international, and we're not going to add the future to our the future insights to our current system. Yeah. Can I just
ask, what about Cashforce?
I think we can't compare with Cashforce. Cashforce is way higher up. They target very big enterprises. When they're coming down to smaller SMBs, yes, that's insights that we didn't know. That could be competition. But let's be first.
And also, if you have Cash Planner and you have already the Cash Planner tool for SMEs, why reinvent the wheel?
Yeah. Jürgen?
Oh. We can't hear you.
Can you do it again? No. We lost the sound? The challenges of digital.
Jürgen, we can hear you.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah, they don't seem to hear you.
Okay.
There's a couple of examples of companies that you mentioned and said, well, we're looking at guys who only want cash flow projections, and that will be probably small companies when they start. But what you see is the small companies become bigger. And so once they become bigger, then they need more stuff. They will need accounting, they will need reporting, and then they quickly move to some other package. And so there's examples in of companies that are really very good in that first segment, but then they can't grow out of it because the competitors they have in this bigger segment are really competitive. So companies move. And so the churn they have is pretty high after a few years. So you have to do a lot of investment to get the customer. And once the customer starts really generating cash for you, you actually lose them because, well, it's natural, they become bigger, they need other tools, and they move out of your solution. So how are you going to cope with that? Because that I see as a real challenge if you only focus on that on these guys who want a cash flow solution at first.
Yeah. Can I take it?
Yeah.
All right. So that's a very good question, and we had this question multiple times from other investors. We're willing to grow with our customers. We're actually testing right now what we need to adjust the product of what we need to add to our product to actually fulfill the needs of mid-market segment as well. So we're talking with them, we're listening to them, but currently we don't have the features to actually provide that yet, but we're willing to pivot where needed to actually scale with our customers so that we don't lose them after a while. But we do want to keep it as simple as possible with the mindset of a little startup or a mindset of a little SMB, also to mid-market. So a very easy to use cash flow forecasting solution, or even broader, it's possible. We're happy to pivot, but that's the main mindset that we want to maintain.
All right.
If that answers your question.
Thank you, Jürgen.
Perfect.
Anybody else remotely?
Frank? Yes. So, Thomas, Dylan, some piece of advice: never start pitching by stating you're not you don't have enough or sufficient end user knowledge. If you want that, make that claim in order to explain that it's very straightforward and it's not as complex as it seems to be, and your product assists in that, I think you have a perfect pitch. But please add these things to it and don't be too modest. Having said that, and also related to the remarks Jürgen made, I also see some conflicts in ICP. There is a tendency they will outgrow you, so you have to a certain state you have churned by nature. Another issue besides product market fit ICP is if we talk about international expansion, how do you cope with different fiscal frameworks? Mm-hmm. Is that already in your product?
Yeah, I get the question.
International.
We just created a solution for that because last week we onboarded a Dutch accountant on the system, and the Dutch system is totally different than the Belgian. Even more, there is no system in the Netherlands. So we fixed it and we made it possible for Dutch accountants to join Cash Planner and to customize everything for their clients. So as such, the different fiscal systems are not really an issue for us today.
Okay, I suggest we basically hand it over maybe to the local audience, see if there's any other questions here. Erik?
Thank you, Dylan, Thomas. Quick question, if I may. You mentioned a couple of times plug and play, really easy to work with, almost zero touch, which is, I think, especially relevant if you're targeting the lower end of SMB because there's basically no IT available. But is it realistic? Does it really scale automatically? Is it pure play SaaS only, or does it still require manual intervention?
It asks for manual intervention when you want to take certain decisions and simulate the impact of these decisions. But to start with, it is really plug and play. We are able to make it plug and play, at least at the moment, for the Belgian market. As long as there's not, and I'm a bit taking a side leap right now, as long as there in the Netherlands not a real system, there's some touch necessary from the accountants, for example. But in Belgium, it's plug and play, meaning if you look at a cash forecast Excel, where you have to fill in all the numbers and check your bank account and check your accountancy system, what has changed and such, all these things are done by us automatically without intervention from us. This is possible. So the user, the entrepreneur, can immediately start off from a filled cash forecast.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question.
I have a quick question. Could you share us more from your experience of 32 customers? What about the sales cycle, the implementation time? That's the first question. Second question, I don't think you really mentioned the business model. How much does it cost, and what would be your customer acquisition cost as well?
So the first part of your question, sorry, was?
Implementation time and sales cycle.
Yeah, all right. So at this point, it is too long. We're discovering how it works, how we want to approach them. We're still listening to them. So now we have an approach to like a more enterprise approach, which is like a discovery call. We identify if there is a match, then we go to a demo, we give them a small demo of 15 to 20 minutes, and then they actually decide whether or not they want to use it. If they want to use it, we set up a kickoff meeting to actually guide them through the platform with their data already in plugged, and then actually make some simulations together to actually see what the value is, and then they are ready to go. So, it's too long for this moment, but it's very, very necessary for us to get that feedback immediately to actually evolve the product. And that's why we want to scale to a more self-service approach where they actually can do it themselves, where there is an automatic onboarding flow so that they can do it themselves. And if they have any questions, they can go to the knowledge base or even question the questions in the chat in the platform. So it's too long, but we want to resize that. From the customer acquisition cost, that's also a good question.
At the moment, you have to count like 700 euros for the customer acquisition cost. With a lifetime value, we think of 3,000 to 4,000 euros for the smallest users.
Okay. All right. And what cost them your monthly fee?
We have a yearly license price of, for the smallest customers, 1,200 euros per year. I'm sorry, 600 euros per year for the smallest, and 3,000 for the biggest users. But it's still, the pricing is still a big question mark for us. Right now, we are pricing based on revenue, and it's we feel it's not the best choice or not the best method. We just haven't figured out yet what the best pricing method is. But right now, it works for us. It works for our clients as well. Mm-hmm.
We started off with a fixed price. Yeah. But that didn't work out for the bigger SMBs, and then the startups, they were laughing at us, and the other ones were in panic of the price, so that's why we made the tiers. But we're thinking about pivoting as well in the pricing to add more modules, etc.
Yeah, we also feel there's room for more. If we pitch our price to our smallest user, they say, that's pretty nice. So we feel there's room for more, for upselling.
All right, one more question maybe from... Joel, you're all right? Michel?
We invest in very early stage companies, and we only see Excel. The other competitors, I've never seen them before. So my question is this. The entrepreneurs that we work with, they struggle to reconcile three things, the business plan or the budget, the forecast, and the actuals. And for us investors, those are the KPIs we want to keep an eye on. And so my simple question is, if I'm a very young company, very, very early on, can I use your product to reconcile those things, even though I don't have yet the machinery, you know, that the other applications that you mentioned in your pitch? In other words, at what time do you think it's the proper time to engage with a product like yours? And is it already the right thing to do when you are a very early stage company?
I think I will start with the answer, and yep. Then you begin.
Go.
Eat your own dog food. We use Cash Planner ourselves, and we are a very young company. But I think our ideal customer profile is not the startup of two or three people. I think the ideal customer profile is more like the SMB with 30 to 40 employees, making 3 to 4 or 5 million euros in revenue. I think that's our ideal customer mm-hmm. profile.
But we do want to promote startups, and we do want to add value to them as well. So, or help them. We give them an overview of their real runway, their real-time runway, burn rates, ARR, MRR. Those are all things that we can actually show them. So it's already in use by a couple of startups, and we still want to do that. So maybe in the future, who knows, will it be free for startups to actually promote startups or help startups better? But it's actually also very valuable for them.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I know at least one happy customer, so thanks for your pitch.
Thank you.
Which is good. 32 customers. It's growing, eh? It's good.
It's growing.
Were you happy with the questions?
Yes.
Yeah. The thing is, in every pitch, when we get questions, we learn so much. It's so valuable. So thank you.
Yeah. Okay. You know what the most important question is?
Tell me.
It's about the hands.
All right, so once again, anybody in this jury who's interested in continuing the discussion with this team, please raise your hand. Also remotely. Ah, there's another turn. Interested?
Yeah? One.
Okay.
We have one.
So.
All right. Okay, so remind that one, a very important one.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, guys, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Hey, bye-bye.
See you. Bye-bye. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this was the second startup. Let's go to the third startup.
Okay, so the third startup is LoopCV. LoopCV is a first fully automated platform that identifies, matches, and applies to relevant roles on behalf of the candidates. And that's difficult. That's different at scale and in multiple platforms. So that's an interesting one. It's a total new thing.
Yeah.
Hi, George.
Hi, hello. Good morning, everyone. How
are you? Good to have you here.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm very curious on that one because there is a battle for talent, huh?
Yeah, that's true. We are going to.
I'm so happy with this one. So please pay attention. This is George from LoopCV. You've got 10 minutes.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm George. I'm a founder of LoopCV, and I want to present you what we have built, which is the first solution for automating the job search. So we realized that there are a lot of people like John. John wants to find a job, but he's very confused. There are a lot of platforms, a lot of tools to use, and it takes so much time to apply. So John has to do a lot of manual steps. He has to create a CV and apply for a lot of different profiles in different platforms, and he also wants to manually search for job listings that match his profile. And then after that, he also has to create emails, sending to different companies, and also fill the same forms again and again, asking the same questions, which takes a lot of time. And also, after waiting for a response from each company, he has to do that every day and every day before having an interview with an employer. And that's what we identified. We talked with a lot of customers and with a lot of users of our platform, and we identified that this process is confusing for them, and they spend a lot of time on things that they don't matter, while it would be better to spend time improving their skills. That's why we built LoopCV, which is a fully automated process. So we removed those manual steps of searching for jobs and applying online, and we straight go on the last steps, which is response, having the client directly applying for a job with our automated solution. So now John is very happy because we apply on his behalf with our tool. So how it works, our solution has two main steps. On the first step, our customers upload their CVs and create one or more different job searches by defining their job search criteria, like title of the job they are looking, the location, and a lot of different other filter parameters that we have. The second step for us is to collect jobs from different platforms like LinkedIn, Indeed, and a lot of other different job boards. And then we match, using machine learning, this candidate with the opportunities that we find. And then we do that every day. We automate the process so that our customers don't have to do any kind of action in our platform. So this is currently how our dashboard works. We have a lot of different metrics so that we can help giving feedback to the candidate that is looking for a job by providing keywords that he should add on his CV. And we also have a very simple process of creating different job titles and different job searches in the platform. And then he can see a lot of different job roles and the metrics for each job position that he applies. What is interesting is that by doing this process, we realize that businesses also have this kind of problems. So there are a lot of boot camps and a lot of recruitment companies that want to help individuals find jobs. So that's why we created also a second product, which is a dashboard for businesses to invite their clients and manage their job search process. So we have boot camps that we are doing demo right now, that they invite their customers, people that have these career boot camps, and they finish the process, and they want to help them find jobs. And what is interesting with that is that there are also very big companies that have internal positions that they want to fill in, so they can add their employees, and we can find the best match for these positions that to be filled in. Our revenue model has two pillars. The first one is the B2C subscription model, which means that we charge for a small subscription our clients to automate their job search. On the B2B side, we partner with businesses like bootcamps and revenue and recruitment companies so that we can offer them our solution for their clients. And currently, we are also building a white label solution so that they can put their logo and their brand and they can add their clients on board to help them manage this process. The job search market is huge. We have millions of unemployed people in Europe, and our first starting point is the software engineers in Europe. There are hundreds of positions, And there are a lot of companies that are looking for these people. We also identify recruitment companies of $15 billion business where bootcamps and businesses can leverage our solution to improve their efficiency and their process. How we go to market is we use online groups and communities. We have a lot of content created to help our customers change jobs, change careers, and we also partner with job boards to connect with them and provide the ability to empower their customers, their users, with an automated job search process. And as you can see in the last bullet, we are also offering our B2B solution to bootcamps and recruiting companies by doing demo with them and adding slowly their clients in our tool. The competitive landscape has a lot of different tools. JobScan and Hunter, the first two, as you can see, they help our clients organize their job search and optimize their revenue, their resume by using keywords. And HireClub is more on the career mentoring side. LinkedIn and Indeed, of course, they are used to apply for jobs, so they have a lot of different positions and they collaborate with companies. Our tool is the first automated job search platform, so we integrate a lot of these features from these platforms, and we also offer the ability to our users to see the feedback when they apply. That was also another big problem. So people apply for jobs, but they don't get any feedback. They don't know what happens, what's wrong with their CV. So that's why, during the process of applying, we collect various metrics like keywords or different statistics from different candidates, and we can give personalized feedback using our matching algorithm. This is the technical solution. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but what is important is that on the top side, we have the job parsing service, which connects with a lot of platforms, and the center of the system is the matching engine that uses jobs and criteria from the candidates so that we can find the best matching for each candidate. What is also important is that we take those jobs and we put them in front of the candidate and he can vote what is good or bad. So he can like and dislike the jobs, and we feed this data again to our matching engine so that we can more personalize the job search criteria. Our customers can also add their own email templates so that they can send personalized messages to the companies and start building connections with them. So here it is. I'm not sure if it's very visible, but what you can see here are the three main components of our system, which is the scraping service, which connects job boards, the matching service, which is basically the matching algorithm, and also the apply service that is using forms to apply and emails that are personalized for each role. The existing traction on the B2C side, as you can see, we generated over 1,000 of MRR. So we have already a solution that is working. Our clients are very happy and they provide very good feedback. And we daily onboard about 200 users in the platform. On the B2B side, our tool is pretty new. So we have currently three demos with B2B clients. And we estimate this to give about 500 euros per business per month. And the way we calculate that is we estimate about 1 to 2 euros per client that is using our platform. So these businesses can onboard their clients and we can help them find jobs faster, which of course is very helpful for those businesses. We also partner with a lot of different job boards. So we expect to launch different collaborations with CollegeLink and GraduateWise. These are job boards and we estimate to get about 50,000 users in our platform. Our team is a mix of engineers and business professionals. Me, myself, I have scaled different businesses in the past. Eddie, our chief business development officer, has is working on a HiBob recruitment company that is unicorn right now in the UK. And the rest of the team are senior engineers working on the machine learning space and the scraping service for Nokia and other big organizations. So currently the situation, I'm based in Belgium, the team is across Europe, and we also got an initial investment of EIT Digital of 15,000 euros to start our prototype. And we also participated in accelerators like Started KBC and other accelerators in Europe. So our focus now is to work on this product, which is the B2B offering. This is an example email just to showcase what we are getting as an input. We have a lot of businesses reaching out to us that they want to ask us to provide value for their clients. So this is from a bootcamp. They have thousands of users, and they want to help them find a job after they graduate from the bootcamp. So we see that our solution has a great fit, not only on the B2C setting, where we started, tested our machine learning solution, but also on the B2B side, where we can help businesses like bootcamps and recruitment companies automate their processes and find jobs for their users. So this is LoopCV. We help users put their job search on autopilot, and we are also working on the B2B setting to automate the search of people. Thank you.
Oh my gosh, what a driving CEO. This is a thunderstorm. This is great. Eh? It's great to see people like this. Eh? And I'm so happy you have a solution on the other side.
Yep.
Because it's not just for unemployed people, it's also for employed people
exactly.
who don't have the time to search and to do this.
Yeah, that's also very interesting. We have a lot of people that are what we call passive job searchers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So they don't search for actively for jobs, yeah. but they want to have a solution like this so that they can connect with companies, and because they don't have the time every day to go on LinkedIn and other platforms, right?
You have to stop this guy. Eh? It's a machine. Eh? It's a machine. And there's a B2B site, which I'm very,
exactly.
very curious about. But it's not about me asking questions, it's about the jury.
Yeah, of course.
All right. There we All go. Right. 20 minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. I'll hand it over to the jury immediately. Maybe start. Okay. Joël.
Good question. So basically, if I understand it right, you are a Meta job platform.
Yep.
So if I'm looking for a job just by going for LoopCV, I don't have to go to Indeed and LinkedIn. It all coming together. Okay.
Exactly.
The second question is, how much does it cost? Do you already know that to find a new customer looking for a job? Because honestly, after 3 to 4 months, they find a job and they are not a recurring customer. So how are you going to, how did you calculate that it is working out for you?
Yeah,
finding
yeah.
new customers, which is expensive. And then with the fact that they probably will be there just now and maybe in 3 to 4 years.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So we realized that this is a huge problem. So the churn rate, we estimate that currently our customers spend 3 to 4 months before finding a new job. And the lifetime value is approximately 100 euros per client. And this can work for us because we have about 10 euros for each client. So the cost of acquisition. And we do that by creating content and ads for these customers. But that's also why we want to shift a bit on the B2B settings, where we have a lot of businesses and recurring customers coming from those businesses, so that we don't have to spend a lot of money on advertisement to bring these customers in. We also have a lot of affiliates. We have, for example, a lot of LinkedIn career coaches that spend time with customers to improve their CV, and then they put them in our platform. So that's also very good for us because we don't have to spend effort and time to bring these people in.
Would that also work for governments?
Yeah, we actually have a demo with the UK government. The interesting part with our solution is that we can connect easily to any job board, so to any platform that has jobs, and we have an organization, a public organization, that asked us to fill positions on the unemployed space. So we connected a specific job board for these people, like blue-collar jobs and so on, and then we can use the same service for those customers as well. And they can use their brand and their logo to have a platform to manage those clients and to engage with them, finding the best fit for those jobs.
All right, Erik?
Yeah, quick business question, a technical question for me. On the business side, you mentioned B2C, B2B2C, and B2B.
Yep.
Where is your focus?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So we started with the B2C because we wanted to gather a lot of data to improve our machine learning algorithm and our product, because we haven't been ready for the businesses in the beginning. After 1.5 years building our product and our solution, now our focus is on the B2B side. So the same product with an extended set of features can be used in businesses, helping them onboard their clients to new jobs. So the same product that we have for individuals looking for a job can be used in a B2B setup. So that's where our focus is now.
Okay. Might also want to consider businesses as end customers themselves. So for example, larger corporations might actually use the matching
yeah.
For internal mobility, basically.
Yeah, exactly.
And then a technical question. You rely heavily on APIs to do job parsing and the scraping of the different sites, LinkedIn, Indeed.
Yep.
Do you have agreements in place to read those data because they're not necessarily all open?
Yeah, that's a very good question. So initially we started by doing scraping, so which we know that it's a gray zone. Some businesses don't like that. Now we have the first agreement with Jubal, so that we use their API. And that's our plan. So we want to become a bigger platform so that other businesses can also see the potential. What's an interesting point on this setting is that we have a lot of job boards that, for example, imagine that I am a company and I pay a job board to publish my job position, right? So how these job boards make money is by providing this amount of users to these businesses. Mm-hmm. And if a business gets 5 CVs instead of 20, that's a problem of the job board. So we have contact with job boards, and they say, we don't care if this is automated. Our clients get more CVs. Mm-hmm. They get more positions, and they get more customers on the same position. So that's why we believe that a lot of job boards are happy to collaborate with us, because we bring new CVs that are qualified by our matching algorithm to their platform.
Thanks.
Thank you.
First of all, your pitch was good. You are an enthusiastic entrepreneur. And
thank you.
See. I have just a comment, not a question,
yep,
related to the last question. I think you should improve your pitch, mm-hmm, because there is a slight confusion. You are trying to create a recurring business,
yep,
out of a non-recurring problem. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't look for a job every month. Once, yep, you have a job. And so that's why I understand your point about B2B and B2B2C. But I think the way you present it makes that part a bit confusing.
Yep.
So personally, I think the key to start this business is your B2C approach, getting young people or old people to find a job, and then extend that to B2B activities. But the pitch is not very clear about it.
Yep.
But otherwise, it's a good
point. Yeah, that's a very good point. The thing is, we started with B2C, and we are still experimenting with the B2B. So we have a couple of demos with businesses. But we see that the churn rate is a big problem for the B2C setting. So that's why we believe the same product can be used on the B2B setting with the same tools and the same infrastructure that we have today to collect millions of job postings every day. Thank you.
All right. Then, remotely, thank you, Valerie, for joining us, by the way. But Valerie is also from Microsoft, so there is some links with your business there.
Perfect.
But let's see who has questions remotely. Anybody has additional questions there right now? Then I have one that actually I would like to add, because I don't think it's covered completely. And actually, there was a question to Mark. Not so much. I hope Mark. Yeah, Mark, can you hear me, Mark?
I can. Yeah.
Yeah. It's to do with the talent market in general. Global companies, like what I'm seeing, and I saw this in this company as well. What I'm seeing in the tech world is that people are starting to recruit global teams, right? So if I look at your team, you're based in Belgium, but you're the only one, I guess,
yep,
from the team. And I see that with tech companies, larger tech companies. I heard some stories recently of very young, very promising AI engineers that are actually being recruited away in Europe now from European companies by Google. I'll mention Google and not Microsoft out of courtesy, or SAP. Globally, just reporting directly to the headquarters, is that a trend that you see, and do you think we will really end also in SAP? Will we end up in a world where people are looking for jobs globally, essentially through these kind of tools? Do you see that happening there as well, or do you still have centers of excellence positioned also geographically within the company?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a mixture of both. I think we, on one hand, we're being a lot more flexible in terms of, you know, making sure that we get the right talent, irrespective of where the talent is based. So where historically we would have been very focused on not having sort of micro sites or micro satellites out there, and making sure that we have a certain threshold of people in a particular area. That's less important now. That said, you know, we are also seeing that you know, some of our employees
are frustrated having had 2 years working from home and working totally virtually. And as soon as they get the opportunity to come back and get into the face-to-face discussions, you know, although it's clearly a different working model, but it's often easier to solve problems when you can just go and chat with somebody for 5 minutes rather than having to book a meeting for 30 minutes or a call for 30 minutes. So we're seeing both, right? And I think we are assessing our location strategy to make sure that we understand where the skill pools are and where we want to be. But we're not rigorous in terms of having to ensure that the employees that we recruit are in a particular region. We can be more flexible.
Right. Eric, what's your view on that from Microsoft's perspective right now?
I didn't pick up the last point. The sound was really bad. So can you please repeat?
Yeah. Well, the question was, do you recruit globally for your top engineers? Because this tool came out of iMac. So they're looking for the first market was top engineers, really trying to look for the best opportunities worldwide. Do you see that happening in your company right now?
That was also the reason behind my earlier question. I think, first of all, well, typically you would have like large R&D organizations centrally organized close to HQ. That was the old world, let's say. Now we seem spread more over the world to have proximity to talent and pots of talent everywhere. But secondly, I also think there's an opportunity in terms of internal mobility. People that want to reskill, upskill, and go for other jobs, which might be in other areas as well. So. I hear you on the B2C things. In terms of focus, you have to focus and start somewhere, but I do see the potential as well for a B2B setting.
Yeah. All right, thank you. Thank you.
All right. Okay, that was not that many questions, but that's a good sign, I think, because it was all clear what you were explaining. Yeah, good point. But it's about the king question, the most important question. I'd like to see some hands. So please raise the question, Wim.
The question before the break. Who's interested in this concept and wants to explore it further with the team of Loop CV?
Three. Okay. That's a good one.
Yeah.
That's a good one. Okay.
Jürgen as well? No,
that was three.
So. No, he was not.
We've been counting three. three hands. Okay, great. Okay.
Thank you great. Very much.
That's promising.
Thank you.
Thank you much for your presentation.
Thanks a lot.
Bye, George.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Have a nice day.
Okay, so this was the third venture, the third startup. We have planned now a short break because I think it's good. We started at 10. People need a short break. I would say that we have a break until 10 to 12, so that'll be a bit less than 15 minutes. So 10 to 12, 11:50, we will start. So please take a break, keep the lines open, and we'll be back to you with three more startups. See you in 15 minutes. Bye-bye. Yes, we are back. This is part two of Defund Arena, second edition of this year, and it's a virtual edition, so we're happy that you're back. I hope that you had a good break. It was just a short break because we want to continue. We still have three startups to go. The first three were QViral.com, then we had Cash Planner and Loop CV. So, again, for the people that just tuned in, three more tech startups to come. They will battle for 10 minutes on the stage, and then they will have a 20-minute time for this one. So we will go for the next one. That will be Raymond. You're already there. Good, good, good. Martin, good to have you there. So Raymond, I'll help you out with this one. Raymond helps teams set up a fully featured monitoring and observability platform, specifically tailored for AI systems. I'm right on that one. The platform decides and solves quality issues in ML-based systems, machine learning. By doing so, Raymond helps teams build better products, maintain them with lower effort, and boost productivity.
That's a perfect pitch for me.
Ah, good. I'm happy with this one. And I'm curious about Raymond, because I'm interested. But it's not about me, it's about the jury. We still have the jury up and running. We have a live jury
and we have a digital jury. So, Martin, it's up to you. We start with your 10-minute pitch. Have a go, Raymond.
Thank you. I hope you're interested as well, just like the presenter. So, as the presenter already introduced, we're Raymond.ai, and we're helping AI teams detect and solve quality issues. And AI has a lot of potential, but it also comes with a lot of challenges. And one of those challenges is maintaining and improving those systems in deployment, after deployment. Because, as Christopher Rees said, it's the dominant factor in the total cost and value. And he's been working at Apple and Stanford University and researching this. And it's really crucial after deployment to get your AI system right. And it's not only in academic research that has been said, it's also usual research like done with AI companies. And it states that 72% of the AI companies need to keep allocating more than 50% of the initial resources to maintain and improve those AI systems. So half of the time, half of the resources needed to develop those AI systems need to keep being used for after deployment. So that's a really critical and important process for us. And why is this? Well, AI teams are currently struggling to maintain and improve this, and it's a lot of manual work. As you can see on the left-hand side, your system is being tailored for one system, for one construction site in this case, it's a client of ours, and it's being trained on that data. But as a company, you want to scale to new construction sites, and that's where the trouble begins, because software is about, is it live, is it up, or is it down? But with AI systems, it's about how well is my system doing in a new environment for a new client. So you really have to understand what's going on there. And those are the needs. So how can I assure quality and assure performance like it was intended to do so? And how can I assess that? That's a really hard question today. And how can I improve my system really effectively? So without constantly retraining, what data should I look at? How can I improve my system? How can I make this easier? And those are the issues currently AI teams in production are struggling with. And that's, of course, what we try to solve with Raymond.ai. And we gave them an AI observability hub to manage their production systems. And we offer them an open source library in which they can log data, input data, output data, and other metrics that are relevant. So it could be about clients, it could be about countries, and so on. Based on that logs, we can give them alerting, really granular alerting about how is my system performing for that client in that country. And if there's an issue, we give them really easy debugging flows to really resolve that issue in a really easy way. And when it's time to retrain or the quality is decreasing, we give them ways to improve their systems in a really effective way by selecting valuable data or testing their models on a new data set. And by doing that, we give teams an easier monitoring setup. It's 5 to 10 times faster than the current solutions. We give them a way to have faster, easier resolution because a lot of engineers now for those production systems are really manually debugging and searching for the answers if there's something going on. We give them some root cause analysis to really see what's going on in a really fast way. And we allow them to improve those models continuously within their flow, making it easy, lowering labeling costs because we can assess what data they should label to improve the system effectively. That's what we believe in. So I'm Maarten, and Karel, he should be here, but he's in quarantine right now as it goes today. We first started out working on an AI startup, but we soon started discussing on all of those problems with AI and all of those operationalizing of AI. And that is what is driving us and what's why we're building Raymond.ai. Myself, I have a business background. I've been implementing AI projects for several companies from a business side. So what's the value and how can we be used within a business context? And Karel is the technical founder. He has really technical experience coming from Sentience RoboVision and also working for corporates. And with Raymond.ai, we want to combine that knowledge to really power AI and help teams and companies forward with deploying and making AI work in production. And we believe we can have a good opportunity in this market because today companies are more and more deploying ML. So it's going from a proof of concept market, let's say, to a really operationalizing market in which ML is deployed in the real world. By 2025, even 75% of organizations will be operationalizing AI, according to Gartner, leading to a 4 billion market in 2025, according to Cognilytica. We're currently working with several companies, of which BASF, VGAB, and Port of Antwerp are in a POC collaboration, which we're working on. And on the other hand, we're also working with scale-up companies, because we can do R&D and really see what's the value and what value we can add. So it's Akkurat, OTIF, Balloon Inc., and Mona. And then we're talking to several consultancy companies as well, of which AI is one, to see what, how can we be implemented for their clients and so on. If we look at the competition, on the right-hand side, we have our substitutes. Today, a lot of monitoring is being done with DevOps tooling. So the classical Elastic and Datadog tooling, but that's not data-centric. It's based upon software logs and more about software, is it up or is it down, and how can we improve? You have the end-to-end integrated platforms of the bigger players, in which we offer, of course, more ease of use and a stepping up flow over an easier learning curve to have that flexibility for teams. And of course, what we also notice is a lot of in-house build solutions that are currently being used. If you look at the left side, we have our direct competitors. A lot of them are focusing solely on monitoring. And what we believe in is like having that AI team, giving them an operational tool, because it's about not about monitoring, but it's about the whole life cycle. And we want them, enable them to do data set building and to do debugging because it's part of their workflow. And on top of that, we also want to be extendable because no system is similar to another, especially in AI. So we want to enable them to add metrics that are specific for their system, specific for computer vision and so on, to really help them improve their systems in a systematic way. What we're building towards is setting up an online low-touch distribution, so that's all go-to-market. We've been noticing that a lot of AI companies or companies deploying AI, the AI team is a really crucial player in the decision upon which tools are being used. So it's really important for us to get in touch with them and to drive interest with them, to drive interest, of course. And what we're currently doing is evangelizing our solution by going to events and to do public speaking and by just demonstrating value. That's why the scale-ups come into play. That's really easy to demonstrate value in a really easy way and a really easy and convenient story. And on the other hand, we have the seamless onboarding we're currently working off. We have a first version of our docs ready in which engineers can run to what we're doing and have demonstrators. And what we're also working is it's free to get started and have that low-touch adoption, of course. If you look at our revenue model, we're now we're in alpha pricing. So for our first couple of clients, we're really stressing the what value are we offering and how can we improve that value. In the future, we want to go to usage-based pricing, in which we price according to how many slices, and slices are for example, segments of data of specific clients or specific countries, so we can grow with our clients and grow with their models, so it's easy to adopt and we can grow with them. And also what is a bit special, we want to work with as a hybrid SaaS, so SaaS is our default options online, but a lot of clients are talking about data security and data governance and so on. So we want to do it hybridly, so which is part of the crucial data is stored on-premise with them, and all of the metrics and metadata is stored within us, and they can have, to put it simply, an UI to process and visualize the data which is on their premise and together with the metadata we have. And today we're raising a 500K round by February 2022 to really focus on the marketing and awareness. So having that go-to-market go live and see how can we work that low-touch distribution even more. And of course, also bringing up our product to a full operational level. because that's really important. There's a lot of assessment and looking at that product, and for the AI teams, it's really important to see that. So let's make AI work. Thank you for your attention.
Good, 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 good. And unfortunately, your partner is not here. But okay, you will also take perhaps the technical questions. Eh?
Yeah.
We'll see about that one. If they're really technical questions, we can still answer them in a later phase.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, all right. Great to have you, Martin. And I'm curious on this one, because this is really, really a startup. And it looks promising, because I really think that, as you mentioned, AI is going to boom even more. So you need to get these systems to become better and test them. And yeah, it's good. All right. Let's get to the Q&A, please.
All right. Okay, maybe we'll start with the remote jury members, see if there's any questions there. There are. Let's start with Mark, maybe.
Thank you. I think maybe my hand was a couple of seconds slower than... Martin, yeah. Thanks for the pitch. I mean, obviously a fascinating area and one that, as you rightly say, is going through a transition, right? We're going from the POC phase, everyone has an AI project, but not quite sure what they're doing with the project, to more of a, you know, business orientation phase where AI ops will become critical. So is it that AI ops market that you're really focusing on, right? So once the model has been created, how it manages when it's in production, how you get value through reuse and continuing the fine tuning, or are you also targeting that, you sort of mentioned the build creation, but to me that seems to be a different market and a different market opportunity.
Yeah, it's true. We're more focused on the ML ops part, because after deployment that our benefits are the biggest. But from a user perspective, it's also important to, we're exploring how can we be more part of the process earlier on, because we're coming now at the end of the process, let's say, and then we have to be integrated. So we're working towards how can we make it easier, how can we be a bit earlier from a product of our adoption point of view. But our value comes after that. So once it's in production, having the granular view on what's going on, the monitoring, what metrics should I use, and so on, and with all of the automation that will be going on, like the retraining that automated and so on, giving the metrics or giving a report about the metrics, that's a really important process as well. Just from a user point of view, adoption point of view, we're looking, exploring how can we be a bit more earlier on, let's say, so we can help them as well there.
And then as the business model or the pricing model evolves, you sort of mentioned that you're moving from a per user to more of a slice or usage basis, but ultimately, do you see an opportunity to move to more of a value creation type of model, right? If these are being used, they're being used effectively, they're delivering value, how do you realize more of that?
Well, for us, the slices are more or less, let's say, a way and towards that value. Because we've looked into, you can have one model for a lot of clients, or you can have multiple models for several clients, and those slices are like something what indicates how complex a system is and how much value it is creating somewhere, because we can have one model be deployed for 10 clients, let's say, in 10 countries, and then we price based upon that slices and the combination of slices at that point. So that's actually our goal, to go to the value, but it's hard at this time to really assess how can we make it easy for our users to assess, okay, this can be used and this is what it will cost, and on the same time look at value and so on. So for us, it's like the slice-based or the segment-based pricing is like the way towards more value-based pricing.
Okay, thank you.
Right. Frank also had a question.
Yes, an explanatory question. Do I understand correctly that the models don't need to be built within Raymond? And if that's not the case, are you able to upload all types of models into Raymond?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's sometimes hard to put it in a general presentation, but it's actually a logging library. So it's an open source logging library. AI teams really can easily implement inside their system. So it's like a typical logger for software. And based on that logs, we get metrics. And those metrics are calculated on our platform to see, for example, is this point out of distribution or not? That's calculated on our platform. But the calculations for the metrics and so on, the distances between them, for example, are calculated within the system with a simple Python library. And they're sent over to our platform.
Yeah, get it. Yeah, thank you.
And yeah, so, sorry, to answer your second question, at this time, it's possible for every AI system. So it's possible for structural data, NLP, computer vision at this point. So it's a generic platform at this time. And that's what we're trying to explore as well, in which area can we add the most value. Sorry.
So I think problem solution is straightforward. More if we migrate from problem solution to product market, what's the first market you want to address, and why?
That's been quite a journey and still a bit of a journey, to be honest. What we're currently focusing on is on AI teams who have some kind of own responsibility and rather complex systems. That's what we really are the best at. And today we're focusing more on computer vision and complex systems on the other hand, because we're working together with those scale-ups to see, okay, what metrics are crucial to really assess quality in an easy way and are low cost as well in computation. So that's what we're currently focused on that computer vision front and the metrics over there.
There's a lot of information on time series, I mean, on data regarding time series, and there's more and more integration of those time series AI into the data set of certain bigger players. So to what extent do you see that as a threat? Because obviously if that's going to be like the AI part of that time series information set is going to be integrated within the larger products, isn't that a threat to you guys?
You mean by time series the software monitoring side or?
Whatever kind of data that is getting popped up by production or whatever. I mean, but always like the regular time series data, basically.
Yeah, that's what we're really actively looking at, because those type of tools like focus on data drift and how much is it changing and so on. And I think what we are looking at, and that's why we're focused on AI teams as well, is like, what are the troubles or what are the issues an AI team struggles with? And it's not always about data drift or one input drifting, because you can have one input feature drifting a lot, but it doesn't matter for your system. It's about giving them a granular view on that. So I think that's what we're trying to do. It's like being a platform, a hub for those engineers to solve problems. And so it's more than automatically doing that reporting and so on. It's like for them a way in to get a system if you...
It's more predictive what you guys are doing.
I wish I could say that, but it isn't, because those data systems, even with our metrics here, it's kind of predictive, but I cannot say that, because predicting AI systems and the things that are going on and the data that is changing is really hard to do. And that's what we're helping engineers actually with. So it's having heuristics, it's about having the right metrics and so on. And like we put a lot of effort in, when do we send an alarm? Because with every client, every situation, every day, we can send alarms because it's drifting and so on. But it's getting the right time to give some alerting. And yeah, and that's, it's not prediction, it's actually just getting just on time, let's say, for AI teams to help them get that products live and keeping them live and only alerting them when they need to do something.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
All right, any questions here? Michel, you had one?
Yes, I will not ask questions about the technology, I'm not an expert, but I'm a bit confused about the stage of your company.
Yeah.
Because it sounds like you have no revenue yet, which is not a problem. You didn't project any revenue yet, which is not a problem. You're an early stage company, that I love that. But you make a claim about competition with all the green dots, which are very hard for us to estimate or to evaluate. And so therefore, I don't understand why you want to raise so much. In other words, why do you need to go already marketing this product? Why don't you raise less, get one or two customers to validate those green dots so that people like us can then assess the quality of the product, the quality of the result that you obtain, et cetera. So my recommendation, if I may, after a 5-minute pitch, it's of course very hard to say, but raise less and come back in 6 months with two customers. Now, maybe I misunderstood, and you already have those two customers, and then, but what's your take on this?
No, I completely agree. I think it's the eagerness of Carol and me to go forward, because the startups I mentioned here are like also new on the scene. And I think what we're trying to do is like that MLOps space is like in a state of flux. And I think we want to go fast, but I understand your opinion and it's feedback we get. But yeah, we want to go fast and we want to have a product that's up to a level that AI teams can use it. And that's sometimes a struggle. Like the consultant we were talking to was like, they're implementing data governance and data security stuff. And then we come with a product that isn't ready to do that, up to that level. And that's a struggle. And of course, that's a bit of a struggle if you have more of a technical product, like we want to push that product forward. But I agree, it's a tension field, let's say. We're working with several clients. We're pre-revenue at this point, but we really want to go forward and push our boundaries on what we can do in that market and that new evolving market, actually.
Yeah, I'll build further on that last point, because I was also interested on your competition slide, where I think you called them end-to-end platforms. You put them under competition. But at the same time, you could say if you want to grow fast and find those first customers, those platforms are typically widely adopted. So have you considered standing on the shoulders of giants and grow with them versus positioning yourself as an easy-to-use GitHub library, let's say, specifically targeted at developers?
Absolutely. We have to stand on the shoulder of giants, but also we have to focus right now. And there's a lot of things going on, and a lot of the space is really fragmented right now. And you can say Amazon SageMaker is doing better than Microsoft Azure and so on. So for us, it's like looking at the field and seeing, okay, on which trends we could look at. And I think our current view is more at the open source FlowML and those automation platforms which we can integrate, which is more of those teams are open to work with some kind of software like us, but with the end-to-end platform at SageMaker, we can add value to that, of course, like the troubleshooting and so on, but it's too early to say like they have a huge platform, we can just go to the marketplace and we'll have a flow of people going in.
Yep.
So that's a bit also our journey, like the MLOps space, it's exploding, but where can we fit in and how can we make our distribution really work? Because that's of course what we're searching for right now, having an easy way to have that distribution.
And then maybe a short suggestion, and then by the way, I hear your point. The ethical and responsible part of AI is going to become more and more important. Maybe an idea when you're pitching bias and monitoring the performance of AI systems, people don't necessarily have to think about the technical performance of AI systems, but how to avoid bias in order to ensure more ethical AI, I think is a good pitch. And that would also allow you to move up the value chain to the very design of the models themselves. It's a food for thought.
Yeah, actually, what we're doing at VidyaB is exactly that, like giving them an implementation of a bias metric. And what we also allow is like an auditing trail. Mm-hmm. So for every prediction, there's an auditing trail with certain kind of traces and all of the data that can be done. For us, it's also a bit of focus, of course, because the field is huge. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of opportunity also in transparency. We're also working with a health a player around that and the regulation there that's coming up from out of Europe. So yeah, I completely agree as well.
Thanks.
Joanne?
How long will it take before you're ready to go to market at scale and to really start scaling it? And then a second question connected to that, what do you think is needed in terms of team to conquer the market with your product?
I think we need half of 2023, let's say September 2023, you should be able to have a really mature product in a sense, not completely mature, but well, to go to market and to evolve from our alpha product right now. And also we want to have that 18 months, let's say, to really get first in the market, get a first name, of course, and have it out there. And that's what we actually need. I think we have three profiles around the technical part, maturing our product, so going from DevOps to machine learning engineers, and two people for the more marketing and business side to get our level and get our name out there.
And is there a way you could go sooner to the market, let's say by narrowing down your proposition to a smaller group? Because 1.5 year seems like a lot of time, and the market can change again.
Yeah, that's also part of our journey. Like, there's a lot of opportunity, and that's what I said before. Like, we have that book with Fedya Bey, but now we're more focusing on the computer vision part because we think that's a more open market. It's a more complex systems and so on. And what we're working with the company I presented is like, what are the metrics that can matter in a more general sense? It will not be for 100% of the cases, but maybe for 60 to 70% of the cases, a low cost in metric, low cost in computation that can be implemented. So that's our shift of focus right now. But it's also about the maturity of products, and that's what we're still trying to find out. It's not like we're emailing and we're contacting a lot of computer vision companies at this time, but it's not like the people responding are like at mass at this moment. So it's about having that name out there and having some going public speaking and talking to people. It's really important in that scene, in that sense.
Okay, one more question.
A last question. You mentioned different interested customers. From some are large companies, some are really startups. Are you doing proof of concept with all of them?
Yeah. Yeah, we're doing proof of concept with the bigger companies because that's easier to work with. With the startups, it's more about a close relationship, so we can have our product implement our alpha product right now implemented in a more safe environment, which we have more control, which we can do next to them and see what value we are offering. So it's the startups, in our sense, is more like R&D, and it's really important also to show value and what we can offer and so on, so we can project it to other teams as well. So like, for example, the Vidya Bey is really a proof of concept when we have to go to paperwork and so on. So that's how we look at the stuff. Because we're eager to also put our product in production and see where is the value, where is it not, and how can we improve that.
And those bugs, how long will they last? And do you think your sample is enough with what you have currently, or will you need to have more proof of concept before you go to market?
Well, the last 3 months, I think that will be enough to assess our value and see. Once it's integrated, of course, and it's interesting, we can go further. But it should be enough to assess our value at that point.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for all the questions.
All right, Maarten, you heard some tips already, like what are your first two clients? And then I heard about speed. They want to have something in the market. And you want to finish products, like prove the real value. So it's like a balance, huh?
Yeah, true.
I know. But it's interesting. Okay. Most important, but I'm eager to learn if they really now want to continue talking or just keep the line open. That's also possible and wait for a couple of months. Yeah. So, Wim, please ask the question.
Yeah, the billion-dollar question. So, who's interested in engaging in further discussions with this team?
Whoa. Oh, my God. One,
well,
two,
a lot of people.
Four, five, six, seven, eight. Eight.
Thank you
already.
Very much.
That's promising.
It was because of your pitch.
No. Did you expect it?
No, not that many, because we're still trying to find where we're going. But it's a really interesting space, and I think we can do something there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Hey. Thanks for being here. It is great, interesting for me and for them, apparently, and for you. I hope for you at home also. So, thanks you very much. Thank you, Maarten.
Thank you.
Yeah. You can go that way. Yeah.
That's promising. Wow, eight votes. That's the most votes we've had today. Whoa, I've been blown away with that one. Let's go for the next startup. So next startup will be Diamond, and they're passing already. So Diamond provides the tool to bridge the gap between devices, am I right, and applications like SAP, Microsoft, Azure, Amazon Web Services. So it's actually bridging the gap between OT, IT, IoT, and the bigger platforms. Am I right on this one?
Yeah, it's actually bringing everything together.
All right,
together.
So I'm curious to learn about how you're going to bridge the gap, because there is a gap, and you're going to be the solvers. All right, happy that the two of you, we will give you, as all the stuff, we will give you 10 minutes talk, and then we will do 20 minutes of Q&A. Are you ready, guys?
Have to be.
Okay, please, this is Diamond.
Thank you. Okay, so let me start with a bit of my story. About 7 years ago, I started as a lean consultant for industry. So that gave me the opportunity to visit more than 200 factories in Europe. And what I saw is that in the process of digitalization, different factories were approaching different steps. Some of them, they were in the beginning where they were just connecting a few machines in order to go with the first steps in automation. Others were more evolved, trying to get the data to the cloud. And in the same time, more vendors that provide those machines created their own solutions in the cloud. And more recently, where Internet of Things appear, things got even more crowded in the industry perspective. We have IoT solutions, sensor actuators that are coming with their own platform. We have the vendors of machines with their own platform, and we also have open platforms. So everywhere there is a platform, there is a device, but where is the data? And that created actually in the market four main problems. Data is decentralized. There is no centralization between the application, the platform that exists. The management of the networks and devices is also spread around the platforms. So if you want to have a global overview, you always have to look which machine is connected to what. Data, because of the layers of cloud solutions, machines, is also not coming in real time. And the thing that is most annoying for the factory owners is that every time they change equipment or they add equipment, they have to repeat all the process over again in order to steer the data to their own data platform. So here comes Diamond. Diamond is a layer in between the physical equipment and the cloud that centralizes all the data and provides a unique environment that enables also applications to use the data in the format that they want. So therefore, there is no more vendor lock-in in that perspective, and everything is managed in one single place. Of course, everything is real-time as it comes just to one platform. But this is not confirmed by us, just by us. It's also confirmed by our clients, and here I mentioned IMEC, where they use our platform because we can offer a unique interface to all the systems that they deploy. And even Actemium, where they decided to use our platform for their clients in the process to go for Industry 4.0. But this is about the client perspective. What we want to achieve is to have this platform available to everybody. And our vision is that we can make from Diamond the platform as a service product that can enable data everywhere in the world. The market is not empty. We have competitors. But we try to stand out from the point of view that we do all the effort. We enable the environment from the machine to the cloud, and we maintain that perspective, so there is no coding. Modularity is actually a very important aspect because we know that equipment change, so we want to offer the possibility to adapt your environment in a more flexible way. Reusability, that brings also scale. So that's an important factor when we want to evolve with everything. And of course, most important, there is no vendor dependency. If we look at the market, we are actually playing a role between the professional service providers like Dellware and managed service providers. And we estimate that 11% of their the effort of the market is something that we can target. Of course, this is a total addressable market. What we want to achieve is the serviceable available market that we believe that is around the 1 billion euros, and that's our target. Leads and customers. We already signed with Actimium and IMEC, and after today, we will continue with the draft joint roadmap with Delaware, but also we approach also the final clients. So we support all the steps for all those companies that that want to go in the digitalization process. Even more with Spacewell Delta Q, we are involved in a Vlio project in order to have a perspective in the real estate. How we plan to do for the next phase. We divided our roadmap in two phases. The first phase is the next 2 years, where we want to create a better network of partners and service providers that we can offer our solution and further offer it to the final client. But in the same time, in order to be able to go full SaaS, we still have to develop the platform, but also we want to create a catalog of devices. That will now allow us to go just data points in the perspective of sales and enable us to connect also with SAP and Microsoft. So all the stream is automatically done and we can scale globally. Of course, we target other markets like cities and smart vehicles as we see that the trend is going there. We plan to break even by the end of 2024. Going to the market, as I mentioned before, is based on platform as a service. That means we sell data points. Of course, we created few features that our clients can use, but most important, we can address all the kinds of situations that are in the market, from the hosted environment that we control to the premises. So the industry landscape is covered from all the situation possible. I will let now Jelle, the father of Diamond, to introduce the team.
Hi, so I'm Jelle, co-founder and CTO of Diamond. And actually, what André already mentioned is the future of Diamond. I will talk a bit about the history of Diamond. So Diamond started in 2011 in IMEC, that was then iMinds, as an answer to a frustration I had in the project I had to deliver. And in 2016, 2017, due to the growing number of projects, Laurens and Anna got hired. Laurens more on the operational side of things, Anna on the more front-end side of things. And then at around the same time, André came to visit us for his PhD. And then in 2020, he joined the team to look at the commercial opportunities that Diamond could bring. That brings us to now. And then we saw that we needed some more expertise in the legal and financial side of things, and that's why Freddy joined the team.
Perfect. So now if we go about the future and we talk about the numbers, as I mentioned, the next 2 years are for us to bridge, to have a platform ready to go SaaS. And for that, we need support and financial support in the perspective that we have the bigger cost in regards of personnel. Even though, from a technical point of view, our cost will not get higher as we don't store the data, we just are an enabler in this full scenario. And that brings me for the final ask. We are here to raise 1.2 million euros to bridge the next 15 to 24 months and to enable Diamond in the market, but also to make it platform as a service ready. As I mentioned, the investment in kind from DFund is already drafted in a roadmap to tackle the next year. We believe that now is the right moment to be in the market. There is a need. We have attraction. So therefore, we are looking for your questions. Thank you.
All right. This is an interesting. Please join me in the front of the stage because we're going to go to the Q&As. Eh?
Perfect.
And I'm happy that we will work together with Delaware. And that will be great. Eh?
Yeah, but that's the idea.
That's the idea. But we also need a co-investor. Eh? That's
absolutely exactly.
We got that right. Okay. Now let's first hear then the Q&As of those possible co-investors. You all ready?
Absolutely.
Here we go. 20 minutes.
Thank you for your pitch. I'll first start by asking the jury members present here if there's any questions. Go ahead.
why are you both relevant in the development of Diamond? Because you didn't really talk about your experience, your skills. What do you really bring to the development of that company?
Thank you for the question. And we were actually expecting a question like that. It was difficult to include everything in the pitch. Yale actually started with Diamond from the situation we were in research back then. And because of the projects and the trends like Internet of Things, cloud computing, he also always was in contact with those projects that require data. And due to the frustration that every time he has to enable data for other researchers to process it, that brings us for today. We saw in 2016, as Yele mentioned, a need for a solution like us in a more scalable perspective, where we were involved in the City of Things in the City of Amber. And from there, we increased the team. In 2018, I was doing my PhD, and my PhD was focusing on Internet of Things and trying to give a qualitative structure of it. And to be honest, from my research, I saw there is no way to create one standard for everything. And I was looking more how to make the translations. And this is how I met them, and I saw that that is relevant. I had a background in consulting in industry. I also finished a degree in electronics, but I was an entrepreneur since 15 years ago. So that brings me to Yele and to the team and say, okay, now is the time to bring in the market. And because Yele already created a team with expertise, technical expertise around it, I say, okay, we have already a team, let's move it and put it in the market and see how everything evolves. And we saw that there is attraction in that.
Another question, as maybe I misunderstood, but Diamond exists since 2011?
It started in 2011, but Yele, maybe it's better to...
How come you are still surviving today without any revenues?
Maybe
Diamond as a company didn't start in 2011. Diamond as a concept started in 2011 within IMEC to support research projects back then. And in 2011, it was basically my 20%, so I did that besides the actual work I was supposed to do. But then, as I said, in 2016, 2017, the project that needed Diamond were too much to handle for me alone, so I started drafting a team, a technical team, because we were still under the umbrella of, I think back then it was still just iMinds, and then we transferred into IMEC.
And to make the bridge there, we spin out this year from IMEC and Ghent University in May. So we are a company since May this year. Yeah.
And so I met André, he saw the commercial opportunities and then convinced me to go commercial, because for me personally, the steps were, I wanted to prove that my idea that I had since a long time, the frustration I had in projects, that it would be valuable in research. For me, that has been proven. And so the next step for me is to prove it's commercially relevant, if that answers your question, more or less.
Okay, Eric?
Yeah, follow-on question. Thank you, gentlemen, for your pitch and the completeness of vision. I'm trying to get a feeling of the product truth, if you will. So you mentioned you covered the whole spectrum from a technical catalog over device management, data management, reporting, etc. Some of those parts are widely available, let's say. So I'm trying to get a feel of what is your true technical uniqueness? What do you really differentiate technically?
Maybe just to use one more slide if this is working. You see, these are the five scenarios in the market available, and they are different stage of digitalization. And you see the first part is A, where there is no cloud environment. And as you see, Diamond is covering quite a big part of what is happening. If we talk about long-range technology, short-range technology, Diamond is covering everything. It's not going in the data processing. That's very important, because this is not our focus, but it's a focus to enable data for those environments that process the data in a more simple and centralized way.
Okay, and a follow-on question. You kind of mixed PaaS and SaaS. Maybe it was my lack of understanding, but what are you really aiming for?
A platform as a service.
A PaaS.
Oh. Yes. Okay. But sometimes when you abbreviate every time, it's flowing very fast in your mouth.
Right.
All right. Sure.
I will pass my time, because we have invested in IoTech. I'm on the board of IoTech, so obviously I have 6,000 questions, but now would not be the time. I will follow up with you guys.
Okay, thank you.
How long, what's the implementation time needed for a new customer, and how is that covered in the cost that you're having there? Is that consultancy fee attached? Or?
So at this moment, we are basing on projects, and I can tell you from Delaware, yeah, collaborating with them, the time for us to enable a project is about 1 day. That is also including the customer talks, enabling the solution on site and being remote. We actually aim to, from the moment you have the devices and you run Diamond on their on your premises, to have the full entire chain ready in 5 minutes.
That's fast.
And is there a lot of maintenance issues?
Maintenance issues, they are not a lot, but there needs to be, you have to provide SLAs always in this environment. And for that, that's the added value and the innovation that we brought with us through the spinning out of process, is that Diamond was created with those elements in head even from the beginning. And because we went from different phases, different trends that appear in the market, we were the first one. As you know, you in research, you always have the first contact. We learn a lot. And we enable Diamond in a way that is scalable and is reliable for the industry. We saw that.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Any questions remote? Jeroen?
First of all, thanks a lot. I was wondering, given the ask for 1 million for the next 6 to 8 quarters, what are you really looking for in an investor? Would it be a strategic party? Would it be... what kind of knowledge or other things besides the money should the ideal investor bring?
To be honest, the ideal investor would be somebody that can bring us to the market faster, has the knowledge in order also to guide us. We are always learning and we are eager to find out more information about how to reach the market. And especially that we said that we do it in phases, so the next 2 years, we really want to be ready in the perspective of going globally. And for that, we really want to have somebody that is able to support us in the in that way.
Thank you. My question is that you mentioned also going to the market faster. Can you elaborate a bit more on your go-to-market with partners? You mentioned that you have part of your business model was going through partnerships. Can you elaborate a bit more on that?
To be honest, we saw what our partners are more used to. So we saw SAP and Microsoft, how they do it, and we said why we should reinvent the wheel. If they are already collaborating with partners to get to the market, why we don't do the same in order to offer the full stack? And our collaboration with partners, and that you saw also my, in my roadmap, is actually to have a more faster and more credible entrance to the market, and that we see through partners, and we have to take to look what the rest of the platforms are doing. And this, I think, will bring us a big difference in the market as we see today. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you. Yeah, we're trying to understand also what kind of value would you bring for these partners? What would be your differentiator for these partners?
What was the confirmation already from the partner is that they don't have to know about the topology of the technology. They don't have to investigate how everything works. They have on a shelf, you can see our solution is a solution on the shelf that you use and you make the minimum configuration as possible and you have already the data in the cloud. And you can already bring your added value on it. I think the fact that we are trying to be part of their offer and trying to be part of their journey to their clients, I think that's also bring a quite a big aspect to take into consideration by our partners.
Mark has a question. Mark, you have a question?
Yeah, just really to clarify on the key milestones, right? You, when I look at the milestones that you have, they tend not to fit into what I would expect for a orchestration or management layer that sits between IT and OT, right? So you talk about integrations with SAP, Microsoft, and AWS, and then integrations with Autodesk, Salesforce, and MuleSoft, right? I would expect there to be a focus on the PLM vendors like PTC, Unigraphics, and others to basically pull in the OT side of things, as well as the integration maybe into the controllers and the device management gateways that you would get with ABB and others. So why the focus on what appears to be more ERP SaaS related rather than IT and OT requirements?
we already have that part so far. So the part where you connect with the machines itself is something just a matter of time and a matter of enabling those integrations that we need to expand the catalog. And what we, so the edge perspective, we already have it. What is required now is to make the full integration also to the cloud, because we saw that most of the data has to be processed in the cloud.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions remotely? Frank?
Assuming you really touch the data, and also as a consequence, you introduce a data security risk, can you elaborate a little bit on the security you are using?
Yeah, so you have a number of parts of the in the whole chain. And so, of course, you start with a device, and there Diamond will adapt to the security mechanism that the device has. And from that point onwards, there's a state-of-the-art security up until the application. So the only part that is potentially unsecured is a part that is currently already unsecure. And what we can do is we can chip away accidental complexities, or complexity that you can control, but the inherent complexity of the technology will always be there. And so then you have to look at other ways to secure that through the network security and such. But that's how that's done.
Okay, thank you.
No further questions, I think. I have one more question out of curiosity, and it might be relevant for VCs who want to continue the discussion with you. Is, do you have spin out of a company, so there, I guess the intellectual property is fully owned by the company now? Or what's the relationship with IMEC as the company, or as the organization, or iMinds in the old days, where the IP was developed mostly?
At this moment, we have drafted a license agreement as royalties, but we also have the possibility to buy the IP.
Okay. So they're not a shareholder? It's
no, not, yeah. Not at all.
Okay. Then I think we finished this session. Thank you very much.
Questions are over.
Thank you very much.
Ooh, that was good. That was good. I'm so curious if your beautiful name, Diamond, also reflects on the hands. And I'm curious on that one. So, please, Wim, raise that Olympic question. There we go.
Yes, the jury is out, as they say. Who's interested in continuing the discussion with this team going forward? One, two, three, four.
We have four votes. We have four.
That's
okay.
Very much an interesting result. So. Discussions will continue.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're happy with it, eh? Four votes?
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay, so after the program, you can start discussing further details.
Looking forward.
Guys, thanks for being here. Please, you can leave the stage by that way.
Thank you.
Bye, Diamond.
Bye.
Bye-bye, Jelle. Andre. Okay, this was Diamond, and what about that last startup? Here we go. Please, there we go, Maarten, Stefan. ILAN is in the business of edge computing as a service. So edge computing is essentially a topology to support the trend to move data processing closer to the locations where data is gathered. So again, a data company. I'm so happy with you guys. So happy with you. All right. This is going to be difficult or easy for the jury?
We're going to try to make it easy.
That's a good part. I love that. I love easy companies. Good. Okay, so as we do with all startups, you're the last one.
Yep.
So it'll be the best one, no? Yeah. The one to beat is eight hands. That's the one to beat. That's a lot.
That's a lot.
Okay. 10 minutes of presentation, yep. And then we do 20 minutes of Q&A. Here we go. ILAN.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. My name is Clement Maarten and Stefan Struijen. We present to you, we are ILAN, we present to you today the OneBox and the OneCloud.
We offer an edge compute solution as a service. What is edge compute? It's the management of IT infrastructure, networking, firewalls, everything virtualized in the remote offices and in the branch offices. Why? Why? What is the challenge of our main customers today? By a growing digitalization, we have a growing massive data volumes that come along. The data is collected in data centers, not only in Azure also, but main also at the edge. This means is the robo-sites, there where the data is generated. By these legacy systems, quite some security issues pop up. Business continuity is very important because if it goes down, there is no revenue. And one of the main challenges is the support and maintenance. If you have thousands remote sites over the world and a server is crashing, you need to go there, push the button and come back. Basically, very expensive interventions. So what do our customers look for? It's business continuity. Cannot go down. If it goes down, there is business impact. Security and data protection, which is for obvious reasons very important. Easy and remote management. Why go to 100 to 200 kilometers drive just to push the button when you can actually log in and push that same button? And a small form factor. Why use huge systems or regular servers? Well, we can scale down and narrow the amount of compute to obtain cost efficiency. By that, we make also a huge cost reduction of the total price. Stefan, I leave the word now to you.
Thank you, Martin. So why would we do that if we don't think there's a market? We think that there's a huge market, actually. What does it mean? If we only look at Belgium, we see 300 to 500 companies who have remote office, branch office needs. As an example, I think DEME, well known, can be taken as an example because they have, on various locations, a need for IT, and that's basically an example. Also, Gartner identified that there is a very big potential. Financially, they think there will be about $32 billion in this business every year. Many companies have already gone to the cloud, but they see quite a lot of shortcomings, as Martin already explained. And because these shortcomings, they realize they have also now to rethink their architecture and move to the edge computing. So therefore, for us, edge is a massive growing business. And we, ILAN, we target basically companies with about 20 and more remote office and branch office sites to manage and to secure. So if you are a customer, how do you think we would do that? We have, on one hand, the one cloud, which is a central component. On the other hand, in every remote office, a one box. If you do that, the one box is a highly resilient platform. You manage hardware, software, security, and network with it. Also, we provide support and maintain that infrastructure. And we are able to provide data analysis, management, data monitoring, and reporting. If you have implemented this, what can you expect from it? You can expect about 60% lower total cost of ownership. You can expect 97% less unplanned downtime. You can expect 90% reduction in workforce. You can achieve 90% on a security scoring test. And you can have 90% reduction in support and maintenance. Now, how do we want to do that? We want to do that on the basis of known technology. We have technology from Lenovo. We have technology from Scale, OpenStack, Fortinet, Splunk. We integrate these technologies into a solution. And we would like to work with partners who do basically the fronting with regards to these big companies who have needs in all these sites. We provide sales support, we provide training, and we provide third-level support. We, in this way, think we can deliver edge computing as a service. We also need some partners to materialize that. That's one of the reasons why we are here. Now I'll give it back to Martin.
Who is Aylan? Basically, we started the concept and we developed the one box in 2017 for a major retailer. The project was that a success that we said, well, we're going to commercialize this. We teamed up with the people working around this project. We further developed the one box, and then we developed the one cloud, which is basically the central manager to deploy and manage everything around the world. We commercialized it, we found investment, we invested into sales, and we invested into development. Hence, our new release of the version 3.0 of the OneCloud OneBox. 2022 will be for us a major year. We are looking for funding to really accelerate our growth. Therefore, we're looking for partners, team up with integrators, and for also to explore and attract much more customers. Who is Aylan itself? Three directors, four shareholders, some private investors. We have six people working around the clock, and four external developers to really integrate these technologies into one solid monolith. This is a system where nobody can go in, can go out. Only we will decide who is accessing what, where, how, and when. Where the technologies we're using, it's flexible, but we make one monolith of that, something which is completely integrated and is out of the shell, a kind of iPhone-like. Our financials, imagine yourself managing 1,000 sites around the world. Just a server crashing, you need to go there on site, push it, and restart it. Well, we can offer a solution that will only cost 700 euros a site a month, which is the total cost for everything. For 4 years, contract, and renewable after that, technology refresh and everything is in there, upgrade, everything is included. Included in this price is the hardware, the software, and the central management, support and services, trainings, assistance, third level support. And we do also deliver consultants and consultancy for, to our customers so they can further integrate all the data which is captured, and basically it's every single bit and byte we can capture. And we can integrate this in the customer's backend. Our financial prognosis is based on the sales strategy we developed with Stefan. It's very traditional, and therefore, the first years we're looking for an investment. We're looking for 150K in January to start with. And in kind, we would love to partner up with Delaware because of the data and the processes where Delaware is specifying on. We are actually the whole surrounding shell to protect and to serve this data. Why are we looking for partnerships? It's really to accelerate the sales and professional services of our product. If there are some questions, we will be happy to explain everything more into detail after the presentation. And I leave it up to.
Okay. that was a good one. You have a solid plan. It's not a small plan, I would say. Nope. It's a strong plan. And I'm happy that wherever, let's say you might team up with Delaware, we might see each other. that's a good point. Okay, but it's not just about Delaware. You all also need someone else. And I'm curious, because you said in the beginning, I'd like to explain it in an easy way. Let's check if it was really easy. Please, members of the jury, questions for 20 minutes.
All right, let me start with the local jury members. Michel, I would guess you have some questions.
I will be brutal, but it's in a positive way. In a way, it's the best pitch I've heard and the worst. Let me explain why. I feel you probably have the most viable business amongst the six we've seen. Thank you. But you have the less fundable. And the reason I'm as a venture firm, because first, I don't understand exactly what your product is. Do you compete against Dell, HP, Delaware? To me, it's not clear.
We use them.
Number two, I don't understand what your IP is.
Yeah.
And, voilà, bon, I could could continue on. But at the same time, I understand that there is a market for services like that. There are partners to deliver this. There are companies who need this. I just missed the point of the funding pitch. Yep. But voila. I don't know if you need to answer this. It's just a comment.
Yes, well, it's true. Honestly, with the dry runs, we let out the technicity because it's way too much. We are really working on every level, hardware of the OZ layers, software, virtualization. We manage the networks, with the security parts, the access to everything. The whole system, all the robo-sites are completely fully integrated and connected and secured into the central system, where all data will be processed and get back to this central system, where you can do the all orchestration of your servers, of your applications, of a new topology. You just log in and you create a new environment. In, for example, in a retailer, you need a new application with hand scanners and whole complex environment that takes normally 2 to 3 weeks to implement one store. Now you go to the central site, you make the configuration for all stores. In the nighttime, you say deploy, and all the stores around the world will be deployed, and the next day people can come in, take their hand scan, and everything will work. It's fully virtualized, it's fully encapsulated into an ecosystem that where we direct and manage all the flows. There's only one door.
Martin, may I also give another example? There are quite a lot of things in an IT infrastructure that you do not see unless they happen. And what we bring in with the technology is predictability. For instance, your hard disk will go down. We all know that will happen. But the question is, when will it happen? With artificial intelligence, which is behind these tools, we are able to predict that within 2 days, the chance that this will happen is very high.
Yeah.
And that is when we say in the slide, 97% less unplanned downtime, that's because of this advanced technology that is being used.
Yep.
I hope that explains a little bit more.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can I ask a follow-up question? Because this product was developed with a large customer, right? With a large retailer, as you said, and deployed into the field. And then you decided to spin it out and start a company and commercialize it. Can you give us, just to get a feeling for the complexity of the architecture and what you put together, a rough estimate of how much development effort went into developing your solution?
3 to 4 years, really, with two of the very good engineers that are have an experience. I myself have 25 years of contracting experience in architecture of compute infrastructures. One of the examples is ViaPass, the toll charging system of Belgium. It's my design. Mm-hmm. So it's one of the governmental institutions that did not go down, but it's focused on there. With the best of the best, we actually made a product nobody thought of before. So edge compute and what we're delivering, our One Cloud, is really to a new market with a new product. The edge compute is something that just exists 2-3 years. People are talking about 2-3 years. And it's really started with the Deleuze project, where Walmart, Tesco's were very interested in the idea of this. Because we got regularly phone calls to say, how did you do, how, what. You Google it, you'll see that my former employer is still pronouncing this and making commercial, for example, for Dell, Lenovo, that this was really a reference case. The first time we made edge compute real happening. And this is the product actually we made, and now we're developing. It's not just managing all those sites, but the applications on those sites, they make data, they produce data. Also, this data we can use, analyze, and make everything out of it, even React on it, because we use some technologies that gathers around, processes everything, and then with an artificial intelligence can scout algorithms and behaviors around this. So the system itself will see, oh, there is a hard drive that has a failure rate. Preactively, I'm going to launch a ticket at the vendor. This ticket will be in the CMDB, will be gathered, and will be followed up by the system itself. So nobody needs to do anything anymore. It's there. Just click, ah, the ticket is nearly done. The moment Lenovo or somebody is changing the disk, they say add to the system, and will come up, and it's done. So the customer itself has an edge system as a service, completely as a service. Mm-hmm. All the technologies used in there, and it's quite a lot. It's transparent.
Thank you. Questions on the remote side? Yes. Jürgen? And then Mark?
Jürgen? Yeah, Mark. I had a question. I'm still a bit confused because I don't understand what your competitive advantage is. I mean, if you look into the offer, what's your competitive advantage? Because in my sense, you're more assembling stuff on the back end, and you're more looking at partners to sell it on the front end. So what exactly... Why would I not be able to do that myself, knowing that edge computing is, I mean, it's a technology that will be available from players that are building solutions on that? So I'm a bit confused. Sorry.
Well, you're talking about integrators. An integrator will provide you a solution with a server, a network, some switches, everything around this, and this is a quite costly environment because this is not really adapted to each other. It's not completely made from the base on. What we do is actually, we did virtualize everything, put it already together just to be configured, but that means that we really need to rework even the products itself. We use Scale, we use Fortinet, we use their engines, where we plug in immediately into this engine and make our framework completely around, so this will become actually a monolith, an ecosystem. We can change, it doesn't need to be Fortinet, we can use F5 networks, we don't need to use Lenovo, we can use Dell. That's open, and that's why we left it open, because some customers say, yeah, we are only Dell. So we develop it on Dell, no problem. Then the whole system can be developed on. So it's plugins we use, but the main framework, that's really our development.
If I may add something. In one of the slides, we said 60% lower total cost of ownership. You cannot do that if you do it the same as today. No. So what we do basically is we use much more advanced techniques, which not everybody can easily master. They're complex, very complex. Artificial intelligence developers, you don't find them around the corner. What we do is we bring that knowledge in an easy way to the customers. That's how you have to see this.
A nice example is, for example, the iPhone. You have a camera, you have a radio, you have an MP3 player, you have everything in this device, but it's just one device. That's the whole thing. It needs to be usable as a service because that's the main concern of those people. Managing 1,000 sites is enormously complex and has a lot of people working around this. Like we said, from Deleuze had, the retailer had 70 people working on there. And now they're using 2-3 people just to manage the complete environment. Hardware, software, networks, everything.
Okay. Any other questions remote? Yes, Jeroen? Mark, sorry. First, Mark.
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm struggling a little bit as well with the business model. I understand the opportunity, right? It's almost intelligence in the distributed edge, but you're coming at this with a very capital-intensive business model, right? You're vertically integrating a stack, you're buying hardware, you're basically buying products from Splunk, from Fortinet and others. So, you know, it strikes me this is a relatively low margin business and a very sort of cash intensive business, right? Why would you not want to partner with a Fujitsu or an IBM or even a Microsoft that have the scale and the ability to take this to market, and then you basically position the intelligence layer that sits on top?
We did actually. We partnered up with Lenovo, Scale Compute, Fortinet. We chose our partners because they're best fit for these environments. We can take other partners, but it will be more expensive. And we did actually partner up with these vendors. Why? Because they're also very interested in this concept. Now they can deliver a full solution. Well, before they didn't. I'll give you an example of Scale. Scale has the hypervisor that can do quite some amazing stuff, but there it stops. They don't have a network integration, they don't have the full security, they don't have the full protection and the access management. We actually put our kind of own controller on it that takes grab of everything. We put our complete virtual environment on top, and from there on, it starts running autonomously. But that's why Scale is, for example, very interested also to sell this to their customers. Simple reason, now they have an added value to their product, which is quite substantial. And from the low-budget, small-featured vendor, now it becomes actually one of the most, the vendor with the most features, centralization, connection to the clouds. It can do whatever they want now. And this is a major step for them. And we're partnering up. We're starting to sell. Well, our first customer we are going to reach for that. We're negotiating there. For them, it's also a huge game changer.
Okay. Any others? Jeroen, you had a question? Or did I miss that?
Yeah, it was partially the same question Mark asked. As I read in the deck, I was a little bit confused because the retailer, which we cannot name, is still a client, right?
It's a reference, it's not a client. We developed a product over there. Then we started our own company. We partnered up with Econocom, and we could eventually go back to the customer selling the complete product now. Therefore, they would instead of doing everything now themselves, it would solve quite some issues for them. So there is, even though this retailer is using the one box, they don't have the one cloud, not the dashboard, and not the artificial intelligence to manage the whole environment.
Because that was what I was struggling with also when I read the deck, is that to me it occurred that you have to deal with long lead times in the B2B segment, especially with the partners and actually the retailer now is proving that. And how does that relate to the fast growth you're predicting?
Well, if I got your question right, they're faced with a few challenges. It's the reduction of cost, but due to this system, they reduced tremendously the amount of people working on there. By automation and virtualization, the technologies and integration and the automation of this complete system got much more efficient. So for them, it's actually a huge benefit because they calculated, while implementing this, they calculated for 1 or 2 years to have already a complete return on investment of the complete environment.
I would also like to add one thing. If you see these numbers, we have taken as an assumption about 25 installations each quarter. But because we have a revenue model where we are being paid per month, so the first installations still give us revenue 4 years later, because that's the type of contracts that we want to have. So that's why you see that the effort we put in 2022 still has revenue in 2024 and 2025. So that's how we come up with these numbers and why we think, although I think you're right, the sales cycle is not going to be very, very easy. Yeah? It's not like I go to an Apple store and I buy something and I'm home and I'm happy. It's going to take more work on our side. Absolutely.
Sales cycles are...
We know that, and that's why we are here.
That's really the reason. Sales cycles are a bit long because we are talking about a vast intervention into their environment. But once they see it, they approve it. And they see the real advantages compared to what everybody is doing today. And also by growing to the clouds, a lot of companies start to realize that, oh, locally we still need that. And that's the perfect moment to integrate edge systems like ours.
Eric, you had a question?
Yeah, a short question, if I may.
Question, maybe.
Thank you, Martin and Stefan. I understand where you're coming from a technical perspective, what you want to do, very clear. And even some of the pain points you want to address from a customer perspective. But I haven't really, gotten an idea on the use cases you strive for. So you mentioned the case in retail, I get that. But especially with that landscape changing, with the advent of 5G, public and private, et cetera, what would be the next use cases you would be aiming for beyond the technology? What cases would it enable in your head?
If I understand again correctly, retail was a nice example because it's a very complex environment with legacy. But what we are focused on is the automation, is everything which has SCADA, PLC, and all those traditional old systems, which are now more and more connected to the internet, which makes it quite dangerous because they're old legacy systems. If you use, for example, the one box, you just actually cut the line between the internet or your data center and the complete site, place the one box, it will scan the whole network, all the devices, it will rearrange it in logical sections, and then lock it down, make a whitelist, lock it down, and then basically what you could do is separate all the danger components out of each other. So everything which is communicating, the one box is scouting, what are you doing, who is doing what. And if there is really an infection like the Trojan, DUCOM, Stuxnet, or whatever, the typical SCADA infections, on behavioral scan, also with our artificial intelligence, on behavioral scan, we immediately capped something. PLC is used to send data files from 1K, a bit of temperature, that's it. Suddenly you see traveling 32 megabytes out of the net, capture this, lock it down, take the two components because you're sure they're infected. And you lock them out of the whitelist and you're secure complete. So, for example, these encryption malwares or the takeover of PLCs will not be possible anymore because we are controlling who is accessing and when and why.
If I may add something, it's not only about the physical components, it's also about the data. In any environment, you have quite a lot of data. You go to a supermarket, all the sales, the stock, everything, it's quite a lot of data. Now you can manage that in a very traditional way and say, okay, on the end of the day, I do my stock and I make sure that the next day I have enough items again to sell. But what is the impact of, like say, a catastrophe like we had in August, where there were floods in Liège, and more than a bit. How does that impact basically how you have to do your stock management in your supermarkets over there? Today, I think that's all manual. What we can do with this technology is to use that data much more efficient and cross-link it with other events that you might have. And these models are provided with the software and can be extended according to the needs of the customers. And this is also very important. And if you do not jump on this wagon, basically, and you will not be able to manage in an efficient way your environment, well, somebody else will, and you will feel that.
All right.
Also, thank for example...
We need to finish it. But I appreciate your enthusiasm.
On this one.
So eager to learn a bit more, but moreover, we'll learn how is their opinion for the moment, because we're going to go for that one big question. Please.
Right. Who's interested after all those questions in pursuing the discussions with this team? Nobody. Anybody here?
No.
Michelle?
No.
Anybody there?
We have one. No. We have one.
Okay. We will need some more explanation here and there.
You see, okay. But that's a, you have a good one. You have a good interest over there. Okay. So, hey, you were the last startup. Thank you very much. You can leave the stage that way. Thank you very much. You can take it with you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So yes, that was a thrilling morning. We've had six ventures, and I'd like to thank again the six ventures: Qvario.com, Cash Planner, LoopCV, Raymond.ai, and Diamond and Island. So six ventures, six startups, interesting stories. Not always easy, but the most difficult part for them to understand what are we going to choose, what are we going to do, and to really learn for them what are we going to do as an investment company. We have installed in a safe way, because we're still in Corona times, we have installed in a safe way some meeting rooms, very safe, so they can continue talking to the different venture, because that's what it's all about. It's about people and understanding where the goal is. That's what they're looking for, of course. I'd like to thank, so firstly, the six ventures, thank you very much. We had nine jury members, thank you for being here live, struggling through the traffic, thank you very much. For the ones digital, thank you very much for coming and for signing up digitally. It's also a big effort, thank you. We have two presidents, Wim de Waal and Thierry Brunel of Delaware. Thank you guys for hosting this one, for helping out these VCs and companies to give a first glimpse of insights into the new ventures. Thank you very much. And then we have, of course, Delaware for organizing and then helping and funding this defund thing. Again, we're looking forward to see which of these ventures is gonna win, because that's what we do. We sign up, we try to sign up and we try to connect these with the different people here. Last, I'd like to thank you. You were the audience. Thanks for tuning in. Normally, you should have been here. That would have been great. But I hope, and I do, I hope it from the bottom of my heart, that next year we can have two defunds again, but then live, that you will be here. If not, we continue to do it the digital way. We're used to it. We'll get used to it. Okay, thank you very much. Enjoy your day, and see you next time. Bye-bye.